put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. Alien vs. Predator from 2010, video game review. This is set, I have no idea when. I looked online, I checked the game. I have not found anything indicating when this takes place, which is slightly odd because we do know exactly when the movies take place and the second Alien vs. Predator game. But then again, we don't know when the first Alien vs. Predator game takes place either, and these are the same developers. Set on BG-386, a planet owned by the Weyland-Yutani Corporation, one of jungles, marsh. There are some mountains, although I'm not sure you ever really go onto them. You really just see them in sort of the distance. Caverns, predator monuments, pyramids, and it has a refinery, and it is pretty bland. This is where the game mainly takes place. Sure, there is a predator hunt on a different planet, if you go along with calling it that, because really it is just a 10-minute tutorial. Think of it as, you know, the game calls it a hunt. I call it 10 minutes of prove that you can take very basic commands and that you can master very simple controls. The alien, of course, has the same. The marine kind of has one. For the marine, it's mostly just the, you know, do you understand the basics of playing an FPS? You know, you've got the WSAD. You know, use the mouse to look around. It really mainly serves to prove just how boring the Colonial Marine is, especially here. Yes, so the plot in detail. The alien escapes from a research station along with its mates and the queen. The marine is forced to make a sudden landing, and he's knocked out and awakens in the middle of the chaos on the planet of the three species fighting one another. And the predator is sent to the planet to aid some youngbloods. Or in short, a planet owned by Weyland-Yutani sees an attack by the aliens on a colony, because evidently this is the only story that these developers can tell, and it did help to make James Cameron's Aliens into an awesome movie. But yeah, the films, the comics have gone in other directions with, you know, I'm not sure that there is a single human colony in all of Alien vs. Predator 2, the video game. There are research stations in both that and this, but then again, that also has three very distinct, almost unique, distinct campaigns with their own plots, their own themes, you know, each with, you know, at least one nemesis per, which of course culminates in an awesome boss battle. You know, each campaign has just a few characters, maybe just one or two, that are central to their story and that you may just get to, you know, depending on the campaign, rescue dramatically or slaughter or otherwise, you know, take some sort of revenge on. And it had a lot of weight to both the Predator and Alien, both their own stories and just their presence in the game, you know, in general, without losing the mystique of the two species. This, on the other hand, spells it out much like the two Alien vs. Predator films. Before I get too far into this, given that I'm going to be talking about a lot of different media of these, basically, when I say Alien vs. Predator, I'm going to try to specify whether I mean the, you know, I'll add Requiem to, the RE subtitle to whenever I'm talking about that movie. And I'm going to try to specify whether I'm talking about, you know, the first movie or one of these three games, since they are all called, you know, at least the second game has a 2 in the title. I'm not particularly going to go into the regular Aliens and Predator films. And I think that more or less covers that. And I'm also not really going to be comparing this to the comics. I'll get into why in a little bit. Yes, in order to fully understand everything that happens in the thin, dumb, boring plot of this game, you will have to play all three campaigns, whereas, again, the three plots, you knew what happened. If, you know, no matter what story you played, what campaign you played in the second game, they just helped, you know, place the different characters in different places and fleshed out overall what was going on. But you basically knew what the, yeah, because these are three very different characters, and it's, you know, every time the three meet, you have to have a good, you have to really balance the three. That's why I believe it's my friend Kiramidhead who has pointed out quite rightly that both Alien vs. Predator films are Alien films that feature the Predator. They don't feel like Predator movies, and they don't feel like movies that have elements of both. They are Alien movies that happen to feature the Predator. And the, you know, the Marines, again, a completely different, you know, the one movie where the Colonial Marines are, you know, part of it, you get a sense of the Marines, and then you get a sense of the aliens and kind of why they, yeah. And again, the second game does this masterfully, but here, yes. So basically, and just to finish off on the plot, the endings are all decidedly meh, all the while actually pointing towards a story, at least one story, that would be infinitely more interesting than this one, which, again, really begs the question why they went for this one. Yes. Much like a typical first-person shooter, this has you going alone almost all the time. When I started playing this, I started by playing the Marine. I played the first level of the Marine campaign, and within the first several minutes, I was just struck by one question after another of and these were not like not the kind of question you want to be asking where you're like really involved. It's just seriously that kind of question. And yeah, there is not that much buildup in the, I mean, even the first game had some buildup towards the aliens in the marine campaign. It is true that this is better than the, actually one more thing on the plot. To be fair, at least there is some plot where the first alien worshiper is essentially just a series of slightly connected levels with no real plot. It is true that this game is better than both Alien vs. Predator films. Of course, you could say the same for A Kick to the Face. The campaigns being as short as they are means that you just barely have time to get a proper grasp of the creatures before before the campaign is over. And gonna turn into a broken, I've already turned into a broken, the second game did it so much better in that there isn't that much that different that you have to learn. And yeah, the campaigns are longer. Now, the one thing I will say about that's mostly true of this and is entirely true of the second game, the alien and the predator, when killing humans, because that's a, you are playing the monster. And I'm not saying that that's a bad thing. I want good monsters are exploration of, you know, themes. I don't approve what Freddy Krueger does, but I'm glad that there is such a fictional creation, because he's fictional and he doesn't exist and he certainly isn't haunting my dreams. It's important to explore these themes, and so actually having the you know, us take on the role of the monster is interesting. But it does, of course, bring up, you know, are you murdering innocent people? And mostly in this, and entirely in two, as the alien and predator, the people you kill are the people in and around the research station. So we are talking about people who have been willingly capturing, torturing, murdering clearly sentient beings. And not like this is going to bring about new cures. No, no, no. This is going to give us a cool gun. You know, when the science gets done and you make a neat gun, yeah. And it's a good way to do it. And yeah, this moves entirely too fast, much like the, yeah, there's not enough time spent with these creatures, much like the 2004 Alien vs. Predator film, when really that is, it's in the title, that's why we're here. I mean, the first time you watch Alien, it's like, what exactly is that title referring to? And as has been pointed out, it's not just the creature, it's the entire, the atmosphere is alien. The you know, it doesn't feel right to us. And that's such a great, and you know, the first time you watch Predator, you know, if you're not familiar with these creatures, if you don't use the word predator to address this particular creature, and I understand, I looked you know, when looking up details for this, I found out, I'm going to mispronounce this horribly, utterly butchered. Apparently, they're also known as the Yautja or Yautja. I like Yautja because it sounds kind of like a bark or something. So I'm going to go with Yautja. And yeah, if you don't go by that, if you use predator to refer to the Yautja, then rather, if you're not using it to refer to that, then the word predator means a predatory animal, you know, something that kills to eat. Which, yeah, so the first time you watch that movie, you don't know exactly what it's referring to. For all you know, it is a tiger or something, you know, and it's just a fancy title for that. But when the first movie came out, Alien, the movie, came out in 79. Predator, the movie, came out in 87. By 2004, people knew, and the verses in the title also kind of signifies, okay, these are two creatures, not, yeah. Now, as for the length of these various games, the first game took about 90 minutes for each, you know, campaign, give or take. The second game took about 2.5 hours per, and the expansion pack to the second game, which exists, much to my horror, took 1 hour per. The Predator takes 2 hours to complete. The Alien, because the Alien is so fast, and it, to be fair, it is difficult to produce compelling Alien gameplay and thus make the game particularly long. Again, though, the second game managed. The Alien takes 1.5 hours to complete. And the Marine takes 2 hours and 40 minutes to complete. So, yeah, we're just barely getting to about, to be fair, that is more than the second game. But, yeah, it's just, it's not that impressive. And again, there's just a lot of things you really have to learn. Where in the second game, essentially the Predator is a heavier, slower first-person shooter character. You know, it's, you play it like a first-person shooter. And, you know, the weapons are slightly exotic, but plenty of first-person shooters, even in the early 2000s, had exotic weapons. You know, there were exotic weapons before the year 2000. You know, there are exotic weapons in the first Doom game. So, yeah. Now, the games that I'm going to be comparing this to, or rather, the basis I have. As you may have realized by my, the whole Yautja thing, Yautja, it's just a, I don't know that much about the, I basically go by the movies because, yeah, the Alien has had two great movies made about it, and the Predator has all of one great movie made about it, and those are mainly what I go by. I'm more interested in the creatures as presented in those movies being done, you know, having just being appropriately represented in these games. And that in part is that I love movies and I love video games. I used to love comics. Yeah, I'm not that interested in just like, you know, if the rest of the movies were better, maybe I would care about this overall mythology. Actually, yeah, I think so, because the television series that I watch that I like. I do care about the mythology, but yeah. As such, I have not played Colonial Marines yet, but I have it on good authority that with all the patches and stuff, it is worth playing, and it was on sale, and I have a tendency to go for, excuse me, sales when it's stuff I might like. I haven't really played other games than the three Alien vs. Predator games that are on PC, and one, like, arcade game where you're playing as a Marine, and you're literally, yeah, you know how arcade games are, you've got the pulse rifle in your hand, and yeah, it's pretty awesome, and it's a two-player game, which means that if you're all by yourself, you can dual-wield Marine pulse rifles, which, much like chocolate, helps fill that dark, dark hole inside. I used to read the comics. Yeah, pick 'em. I probably read them. The Alien ones, the Predator ones, the Alien versus Predator ones. It has been a while, and I didn't really, I don't remember them particularly anymore. I probably won't be playing Alien Isolation. It sounds like it's just too frustrating for me, and I have a low threshold for frustrating games. But yeah, I've watched every Alien film, every Predator film, you know, both Alien vs. Predator films, and a few fan films. Including the Batman one? Yeah. I guess just in case of spoilers, I maybe shouldn't give away exactly what that one's called, but it's easy enough to find out if you're like, I don't care about spoilers, I want to see Batman, and yeah. Yeah. Now, this game is severely unpolished. It's remarkably dated. Some have said that it's essentially the first game with a new coat of paint. I wish I could disagree particularly. It is not worth the wait, and you definitely shouldn't buy this unless it's on sale. And even then, others have already pointed out that the game is a series of little elbow jabs of, remember this from the films? Yeah, again, not unlike the first game, which had some qualities beyond that. Singleplayer is essentially training for multiplayer. This tries to fit in to the two Alien vs. Predator films, which others have already pointed out is a pretty huge mistake. And not only because they suck. And, you know, of course it does, you know, Prometheus coming out 2 years after this does, you know, I mean, it completely retcons out of existence both Alien vs. Predator films in order to set up a similar scenario to Alien vs. Predator. This does not quite suck as much as the sequel to Prometheus, Alien Paradise Lost. Unless they change it to something even stupider. Nor Prometheus itself. And if you wonder why exactly Prometheus sucks and why Alien, the sequel to it will also suck, watch Film Brain's Bad Movie Beatdown. He puts it more succinctly than I could hope to. And the Spoonie has some choice words for it as well. I find myself quoting his, "This is why we can't have nice things." Yes. For some reason, this does not follow the second game, which sets up some really compelling story stuff after having a great story. See, rebellion, it can be done. There is a little bit, thankfully only a little bit, of backtracking in this. Much like in Ambush Predator 2 Primal Hunt, the expansion pack. I've sort of already said this, but just to really establish, AvP 2 is better in almost all respects than this. The dialogue is utterly insipid. This does have strong female characters, which, is quite common to the Alien franchise, and other than the first movie, the Predator franchise. Unlike Requiem, this is not a teen slasher that happens to feature the two creatures. It's not really a secret. Lance Henriksen is in this as a character related to a character. I suppose there's not much I can say without spoiling the films. But if you've watched the films, you have an idea of, yeah. And it was fortunate for the developers who clearly wanted to attach this to the films that Lance Henriksen, much like his appearance in the first film, the first AVP film, will appear in almost any, no matter how poorly written. Unlike the second game, you're not playing as sort of a Hicks character. Unlike the two AVP films, Predators, the Queen, as seen in the first, yeah, and mainly the Predators in the first of those films, and the chest bursters of Requiem are not huge here. It's like the directors forgot. These are not scary because and are awesome because they are huge. They're actually not that big. The Predator isn't that much bigger than a human being, and the alien. Before, the queen is fairly big, but not huge. And yeah, the chest burster, it's scary in spite of not being that big. It's the fact that something relatively small, I mean, you could almost palm a chest burster if you roll it together, you can almost palm it, depending slightly on the films. You don't need to make it huge to make it terrifying. As the only first-person shooter that I've played in a while, I mean, I would say, like, yeah, I suppose mostly modern ones. This does not have down the sight aiming. You fire it from the hip as like you used to in the first several first person shooters. You can't crouch, which again that goes back to that's like one of the very first person shooters allowed you to crouch. You might also say that the basic jump is fairly useless, especially for, you know, outside of the focus jump, the predator's leaping ability, which I will get into. Yeah, I especially wish that the alien didn't have a regular jump. I'll get into why. You also can't lean, which, to be fair, yeah, not every first-person shooter, even modern ones, allows for that. But, yeah, I why even... Yeah. Now, why even make a modern first-person shooter if you're going to remove that many of the very attractive features of modern first-person shooters? I have a tendency to not always finish my thoughts. I tend to get distracted. And when I get distracted, the technology is yet again interacted with, as in, like in the first two games. And here, in the second game, what the alien would interact with tended to be tearing through vent covers and maybe a partially broken door, maybe disabling, you know, it might cut the power. What do I mean? Cut the power. It's an animal. By, yeah, tearing through some wires. That made a lot of sense. And the predator, given that it's quite intelligent and that it does have human hands, pig, it can press regular buttons. I mean, it might not know, like, the complicated, you know, codes or whatever, but it can press regular buttons. In this, the predator will... I mean, it does at least still use some kind of electronic device to basically suck out the power stored in, I don't know, I'm not sure, there may be supposed to be like generators or something that the humans set up. But other than that, it'll often interact by stabbing a panel or the like with the wrist blade, because apparently the predator is like one of those big, angry, you know, ape, monkey creatures that if it can't quite figure out how to properly interact with something, it just goes, you know, smash! And the alien will still sometimes break things. Sometimes these are like panels and such, because why not? And the way the alien breaks that is, you know, it doesn't like tear through it with the claws. It doesn't stab through it with the tail. It uses the tongue to go into and the tongue isn't even that long. I mean, it reminds me of that movie. I want to say it's a Die Hard clone featuring a woman in the lead role. She's been in other B action flicks, and it's not like a big known one. It might have gone like direct video or something. I wish I could remember at least one name connected to it. I want to say that the main bad guy is either Andrew Dice Clay or the Rourke in Sin City that isn't played by Nick Stahl or Rutger Hauer. There's one scene where she finds the hacker and she has to you know, stop the computers. So, you know, she's gonna, like, tear apart the tower and, like, mess up the... No. She does something much more efficient. She shoots the monitors. Yeah, it... What I'm saying is it probably wouldn't really work, and it's a goofy, goofy thing to see. Yes. The paths in this are entirely linear. You're practically led by the nose. And at the same time, if you don't know exactly where to go, you may have real trouble figuring it out. There are a lot of seemingly, you know, the paths that seem like this is supposed to be the way to, you know, to proceed, and then it isn't. Yeah. Unlike 2, you never get to blowtorch through something in a tense situation. You never get to weld something shut. You know, to be fair, you also didn't have the excellent, you know, inspired experience of, you know, welding doors shut to really block, you know, in an arena where you can maybe choose which door to weld shut and direct where the enemy might come from. I understand that that's in the killing floor. Don't worry, it's not really a floor. It's more like a grating that allows... I haven't gotten to playing that yet, but I am looking for... Who would think that the developers who made the two... Crap. Red something... Ostfront, and then two Heroes of Stalingrad. The two war games set at the Eastern Front, which are both intensely accurate, would then also go and make this gory, you know, intentionally offensive, over the top kind of zombie, I think, shooter. Yeah, it's that's. Wild. Yeah, much like in Left 4 Dead 2, we have acid blood. And, well, I suppose in Left 4 Dead 2, it's not really blood, I guess. It's like the bile or something. Anyway, yeah. And, yeah, you'll want to get out of it, although it's not as scary as that, the stuff in the first. And the second, you know, in the first, if you're real close to an alien when you kill it, you never want to have your back too close to the wall. Because if you can't back up after killing an alien, you can't go away from its corpse. I mean, you know what happens to a corpse. We know this. We've all been in the situation where you're standing with a corpse, and it's like, it's Wednesday again. The blood might spurt out, and the acid will utterly burn through. I mean, they you know, when they did the first game, I seriously played on the easiest difficulty setting, just try to stand where an alien dies. They watched those first scenes of acid blood, and they were like, we're gonna do justice to that in our game. And yeah, it's, I mean, it doesn't burn through floors that you can see. They don't, you know, it's not Red Faction. They don't have that kind of destructible. It's still acid, at least. And if you shoot the legs off an alien, it's not necessarily going to die. It'll just come crawling at you. And, you know, all three creatures in this have a sprint, which is, you know, at least that of the modern first-person shooter features. Yeah. Unlike the first one, there aren't really tasks where you have to, you know, if you play the first one and you're not really paying attention to what you're being told is your current mission objective, you can run around forever not figuring out what to do. You genuinely have to know, okay, now I have to go there and I have to flip this and that many switches, or I have to go there and break this or that. If you don't know, you're going to die over and over, or failing that, you're just gonna straight up run around not knowing where, what you're, it's more gonna be that you don't know where to go or what to do if you're not paying attention. And yeah, in this, everything is easy to do. There are elevators that activate just by someone walking onto them. And I know that that's like, oh, futuristic, it's, well, futuristic, I suppose today might even, I don't know enough to say they may well already exist. Certainly the technology is there. If they don't exist, it's a safety feature kind of thing. But yeah. I get that it's, oh, in the future we're gonna have. Given that these are human installations, would you not prefer that an elevator activates only when someone presses the button, just in case, an alien might get out or something? You have a lot of safety features. You also have a lot of aliens. So, just in case. Yeah. And it's, yeah, there's nothing to it. You just go to whatever you're activating. Typically, you do have to press a button. It's only really elevators that activate on their own. But yeah, that's it. You just press the use key and it'll do what you need it to do. And yeah. Again, the second one, you have the hacking bits. You might have to, blowtorch or weld. The Predator has a sort of hacking thing, which basically it seems to like overcharge the thing and then break it. That might, if you do that on a door panel, yeah, that might open the door. That makes decent enough sense. Makes more sense than just. I get it. You like the whole thing of stabbing, and both creatures do a lot of stabbing. I guess if all you have is a stab feature, everything looks, yeah. Regardless of which of the three species you are playing as, you will get to fight both of the others at least once. Which is again also true of even the first game. To be fair, there is a lot of good to the first game, but yeah, that was also true of the first two. Trees no longer look ugly. This is very scripted, so not a lot is going to change on replays. The levels get old and repetitive. The single player. Almost immediately, I was shocked. It's because the gameplay is so thin and superficial. It's hard. It's really difficult to make shooting xenomorphs boring, to run around as a predator boring, but this game manages. The HUD can be somewhat difficult to read. I appreciate that the streamlining is actually mostly good. There's not a lot of different things you have to look at. You just have to know how to read the different things. But the game doesn't really tell you how to read these, or at least, actually, to be fair, it might have just been that there's a lot to take in during the opening tutorial. Actually, yeah, I think the game does overall tell you how to read these things, but there is so much information right there just dumped on you, where a lot of games try to have an opening tutorial, and then over the next levels, you pick up a few more things instead of, yeah, just dumping it all on you. But yeah, overall, there's some really good elements to the HUD. Now, the health regenerates regardless of which all three species, but the alien doesn't have an actual item for healing, which I don't know what they thought was wrong with just tearing apart bodies for health. It was in the first two, and it worked really well. And, you know, the head biting would also provide a tremendous amount of health. Yeah, it seems like, and in this, the head bites are even rarer, even harder to do than, you know, I mean, before you had to be real careful. In the first, it can be relatively hard, because even the tail might take the head off, and ripping in the upper body might take the head off, and then you don't, yeah. In the second one, that does become much easier. In this, it's made difficult again, so I don't really understand why they didn't have that give you more health. In multiplayer, you know, once you've lost a bunch of health, I mean, either you can just try to find a good hiding spot and wait for the health regen, or you probably just have to rush at someone else, and maybe you'll manage to kill a few more before you die. But yeah, why not just have a proper feature for that? The controls for both the alien and the predator can be really difficult to get a proper hang of, and the predator has really badly, you can really tell that it was made for consoles, because for the predator you have to use, someone else pointed this out, like 3 or 4 buttons to use him with any kind of result, and that works if you're holding a joystick, but not on a keyboard. No one would care about this game if it wasn't for the license. Again, someone else pointed this out. This plays more like a first-person perspective action-adventure game, action game mainly, rather than a first-person shooter. The game has a high learning curve. And it, especially for the multiplayer, where everyone you meet, most of the players you meet, have years of experience on it already. And yeah, and the single player does not teach you all that you really need to know, which again, it wouldn't be that difficult. It, just have an actual multiplayer tutorial for the things that are hugely different. And yeah. There are levels for both Alien and Predator where you get to attack Marines who do not expect, or humans in general, who do not expect you, much like the second game. It's a little bit in the first. You can now lunge as the alien, which is not quite the same as the pounce. I will go more into detail on both of those, but yeah, it's the lunge is it's different. I will get more into why. And the predator can now focus jump, and using focus, I'll get more into that, but using focus in general highlights important information. You know, it might tell you what kind of weapons does this enemy have. You know, maybe it highlights where weapon pickups are and such. Again, others have pointed this out, the the alien and the predator are both too powerful, and it's just not as much fun to play single player. The second one did this to an extent. The first one did a lot better in that. And the... breaking light sources can be very useful for both... yeah, both the alien and the predator, and, you know, make it easier to hide in the darkness, and forcing the marine to use his shoulder lamp, which will give his position away. Regardless of who you're fighting and the exact situation, it's very useful to shoot them in the head. And yeah, just you'll really be able to tell a huge difference from doing that versus even the chest. It's obviously it's harder to hit the head. It's a smaller target, but it really makes a difference. And the lunge and the focus jumping now allows the predator and alien to really chase each other around the, in multiplayer, around the arena. And neither of them can particularly get away unless they're like luring the other into a group of, enemies or such, by itself. You can now basically, there's an instant kill move. And before I get into too many details about it, the predator, we already know that the predator has a bit of a thing for taking off people's heads. And in this, there are times where you take off the head of, like, the officer in charge and use his head to pass retina scans, which, I'm not sure this is, like, the first to really... It's not the first to do something like that, but it's still... it's not bad. Now, the insta-kill move will let the two, this, what I'm going to be talking about for the next little bit here is mostly, it's only for the two non-human species. Yeah, the predator and the alien have some specific, especially powerful moves and tools and the like that we only really see in these, the grab move, and it includes such thing as the predator ripping out a tongue or breaking the spine of aliens. The alien might stab with the tail. And head bites are also part of this. For some reason, outside of that, there's almost no gore. I could not believe it. The second one, the first has pretty good gore. It came out in 99, The second one has excellent gore. I mean, You're facing the enemy as an alien or a predator, and you're tearing them apart. And there's like spines, eyeballs, the rib cage, and all these different things. Actually, spines. Anyway, at least one spine. Yeah. And it's just, it's so satisfying to both. I mean, as the predator, you're not even gaining health from it. You're just doing it because it's fun. And Like I'm not against the idea of us people in general playing as the monster, you know. And again, you know, in this you are at least in the second one, as you know, entirely everyone you kill has helped with the abuse of these species. I mean, I'm not asking you to cuddle with the alien and the predator, but I am asking you. I mean, if you're looking at them and you're like, I bet I could tear that thing apart and like use it for some, maybe don't. And it's just, I don't know why they would remove the gore. The best I can come up with is in multiplayer, they don't want the player to stand still over the corpse of another player. And, you know, just even if you allow for them to do that, if it's not very beneficial, they're not gonna do it. You know, or the ones who do it are just gonna, you know, sit there and get killed by a player who isn't just sitting around. It's not, yeah. And especially considering how gory the grab kills are and how gory these films are, it's just, it makes no sense that they would do this. Yeah. Now, others have already pointed out the grab move is severely spammed. You know, you can spam it in single player, a lot of people spam it in multiplayer. And it does take a lot of the fun out of it. To be fair, you know, it really does expose you. You are utterly, utterly vulnerable during those. Yeah, you know, on the plus side, the moment you pressed grab, the other player is going to die, even if you're killed immediately after. Yeah, it is going to that. And obviously, if a bunch of people meet in one place and one grabs the other, yeah, you know, they basically all are going to end up dying. Whereas if a bunch of people meet and they're going for like a melee fight, there's a little bit of a chance that they will, you know, that you might maybe manage to kill more than one person, maybe, you know, yeah, be able to avoid the other player's attempt at, you know, and you can't just grab, you have to, in multiplayer, the person has to be unaware of your presence, and or just, you know, sometimes it's also just if you're behind them, even if they know that, even if they've just spotted you and then they turn their back. Yeah. And the you know, if you maybe knock them down or the like, you can grab. But yeah, it is too bad that it's, you know, that's something they should have de-incentivized. They Is that a word? They, because that is all over the place, and yeah, I remember someone reviewing it said, you know, they're put down the controller and watch insta kills. Spot on. That's exactly what they are. The Marines. Yeah, moving on to the Marine. Basically, his plays somewhat like survival horror. You do not get to, you know, set up the sentry guns like you do in Primal Hunt. You don't get to ever use an APU, which you may just get to in at least one of the games, and certainly in Primal Hunt's insane and unfair multiplayer. I don't know what made them think that giving the Marine two weapons like that would at all let the game be fair. It's insane when aliens and marines fight each other. Yeah. I mean, the APUs aren't everywhere, but even one is, yeah. The, you know, you have a radio receiver, but you can't, you know, actively, you can't, you know, get the character to respond to that. I think there was at least one time where it seemed like, you know, the other person had heard a response from me, but I guess it was telepathic because I didn't hear my character say anything. Yeah. You can strafe, and that is immensely useful. You have to watch out for eggs, you know, and there might be some, not really floors, but there's at least one door that the you know, that an alien might break through. Actually, come to think of it, I think there was at least one grating under that they eventually tore through. That, yeah. And the alien itself, and you know, when you're playing as the alien, it can crawl on any surface, and the, you know, it can jump from any surface to any other surface, you know, provided obviously distance, but that's literally it. The thing is that it doesn't always work. And yeah, it's really frustrating when that screws you over in multiplayer. And you know, you cannot jump from the ground to another part of the ground. You can't wall jump from that, but you can wall jump from the ground to another surface, you know, a surface that is in the ground, and you can jump from any surface to the ground again, obviously barring, you know, distance, and you know, you can like let go and let gravity do its thing. You know, it's a colonized planet, so you know, it's done the shake and bake thing. You have a hiss ability, which is not that useful in multiplayer. You know, I've read that some people use it to like lure, you know, marines or predators into an ambush, like saying, okay, I'm gonna come from this, you know, I'm gonna come at you from here, and then they go in thinking that, and then the, you know, your fellow aliens come from the other side and slaughter them. But I don't know, it seems like that would just, you know, when you catch on, I didn't experience that situation much, but I feel like, yeah, it's not that useful overall in multiplayer, it seems. It's very much a stealth game as the alien, and, you know, even, you can apparently even use sound. I had to find this out from a video guide. I don't know why they didn't say that in the game, which again, I'm pretty sure they didn't, at least. You know, the surface that you're moving on, which again, you can't necessarily do much about, so it's not useful. But yeah, the, you know, I don't know, maybe they thought that camping, which everyone hates, or just really roundabout ways of getting to, like, if you're seeing, you're here, the enemy's here, and you're like, well, to get directly to him, I'd have to walk across metal. I don't know. I guess you can get to a position where you can jump closer, and then maybe it doesn't seem like it's that useful of a feature overall. But it is like, you know, moving on surfaces to different surfaces, making a different amount of noise and such. I mean, that is straight up Thief You know, it's not in Thief 2014. So like I said, Thief. You know, if they were gonna put something like that in, I'd really rather have the swoop from Thief 2014, so that you could very quickly, but also slightly more noisily, move from, you know, the surface that you're already on to further along that surface very quickly. That, yeah. Again, I get it, you know. Claws on metal make noise, but you know, then we get into, you know, a ton of different things that video games allow you to do that you don't in real life. So yeah, when the, you know, yeah, you're typically the only alien in, you know, in single player. You're the only one running around. You're not running around as part of a pack. In single player and survivor, you will see Praetorians, but you don't get to play as them, unlike Anniversary Predator 2. And you will also face combat synthetics. And take one guess as to whether the head is useful to take off and whether or not they might live on a little bit after that. You know, you have an ability called surface transition, which when you're upside down just means letting go. But if you're in a narrow corridor, you can jump from one side to the other at just the press of a button, which, yeah, very useful for very quickly getting to another, yeah. And the, I have to go into how this opens. The second game has you going through the entire alien life cycle. You start out as, you know, you see your egg open, and then you emerge as a face hugger. You get to run around, you know, and you end up face hugging, and then you get to chest burst. In this, you just see your own chest burster as the first thing, and you, like I said at the start of this, you are in a research facility, which you then go on to escape from. It's in the first level, and it's like in the opening minutes of the first level that, oh, the power went out, I guess, you know, the aliens are going to escape now. When you first see your chest burster, you realize that there are these glass tubes right on the outside of these people's chests, which again really highlights these are not nice people. These are really horrible because they are literally using other people as hosts for aliens so that, you know, for their research. Yeah, you know, so they all chest burst and these tubes close afterwards to leave the chest burster in to preserve the flavor. However, they notice that your tube is empty. And that's because you were smart enough to crawl back through the hole in the chest. You're gonna have to get out some other way, right? So the closest, and yeah, you're gonna go through the throat and the human, you know, you force open the human's mouth. Or, you know, yeah, his mouth opens. It's been a little while since I saw the cinematic, but yeah, his mouth opens, and then the chest burster pops out, and then its inner mouth, you know, the tongue thing, also opens. So we have three open mouths. I am certain that they meant for this to be grotesque, but man, is it silly. It is the goofiest thing, and you cannot help but laugh. Yeah, as others have pointed out, the alien, you know, playing as the alien, whether single player or multiplayer, really requires good spatial awareness. Now, you will always see the, you know, there's this arrow at, you know, acting as the part of the crosshairs. It will always point to the ground. So regardless of which surface you're on, you will always be able to see where is the ground in relation to me. Now, you really wish you could circle strafe because that is an immensely useful ability in a first-person shooter kind of thing. And your strength is really being on walls, and thus, yeah, you really circle strafe. Just like, you're not on the ground. It would be much easier if the alien was on, was that good at being, when on the same, level, not necessarily the ground, but on a horizontal surface where the other two are. It's not necessarily going to be the ground, but yeah, so you could circle strafe and that whole thing because, yeah, once you're on the wall, I mean, sure, you can jump back off the wall, but then you're just off. It's not that useful to be, on the same surface as the other two. And yeah, the given that you can no longer pounce, it's been really, for those who haven't played the second game, I'm not certain the first one that it does damage. In all three, you can jump very far. In the second game, you have an ability called the pounce. It allows you to not only jump very far, but it does damage. And depending on the distance, the shorter the distance, the more the damage. Because you are literally throwing yourself at another, yeah. And if you do that, the body will completely disappear because you practically tore right through it, it's gone. Which means you cannot get any health from that body. So it was a tactical decision. Now, like I said, the lunge does no damage. The pounce gave the alien something useful for ranged attacks. Now you have to lunge and then attack, and it's just not as useful or as powerful as it really should be. The fact that the predator is so much easier to figure out and easier to use and stronger just makes the alien much less useful than it should be. And, the moment that you are engaging in regular melee, the moment that the other player knows you're there, it's almost going to be too late, especially if it's a predator. And yeah, it shouldn't be like that. The something extremely useful for the alien here and in the films is, the surprise, but yeah, it's just not as. When you can't always surprise, especially multiplayer players, because they know that you're there. So you can't really. Maybe if they had made some kind of, I don't know, something that would mean that players never knew if they were going to be facing an alien or a predator, so they would constantly. I mean, as it is now, you can always tell how many there are, so how likely it is that you'll run into, and sometimes it is equal, but that still means that okay, I'm watching out for both. So yeah, maybe if the other players were completely having to only be ready for one of them, and so the alien would be able to surprise like that, but it's just not like that. And yeah, it makes it much less dangerous. It's just not as strong as the predator, and thus, even facing a marine, it might not completely be able to kill if it didn't surprise him. Now, you can, if you're at the ceiling, if you're on the ceiling, and there isn't that much distance between the ceiling and the next horizontal surface, you can use your tail and it'll be instant. And that can be extremely useful. That can be a one-hit kill if you do it to the head. But that requires the player to be unknowingly walking into that. I mean, yeah, the players know what, you know, which areas allow the alien to do that, so they're just extra careful for that. And again, do you really want to be camping there? It's, yeah. Again, the other two can really throw themselves into fights, you know, so, yeah. Now, the alien's vision, where in the first two, other aliens are red, predators are green, and marines are blue, which also fits with their color schemes. In this, threats are red. And, I mean, in single player, that's basically fine. You can tell, okay, that guy doesn't even have a gun, so I can save him for later. You know, I think they're, like, blue if they're not threats. In multiplayer, it means that at a distance, any enemy you look at is going to be red. So you don't know if it's a predator that you have to be extremely careful around, or it's a marine that you can maybe rush. You know, like I said, sometimes that will work. And especially if you catch them by surprise, which is, you know, rushing or hiding are, you know, ways to surprise the other. I appreciate that it's the same for the Predator. The Predator has electrical vision, which is for aliens, and heat vision, which is now for both humans and Predators. Where, again, in the second one, there was a third vision. Yeah, both of the previous ones, there was a third vision specifically for Predators, you know, so, and their technology. And yeah, in this, so the Marine as well, the Predator as well, has both, it can't tell the difference from very far away. However, the Predator is so powerful that it doesn't mean as much. And most of the time, if you're playing as a predator, other predators are on the same team as you, you know, or, yeah, it species, modes where the members of the same species are on the same team are the most commonly played. So when you're looking, allies are marked with arrows and their names above their heads at all times. So you don't mess up with that. So, yeah, it's another handicap for the alien. This does fix something that genuinely was, like, in the first game, headbiting might just take the head off. It might, you know, it might not, like, eat it. In the second game, distinctly, if you're headbiting, you are biting the head off and, like, swallowing it. That's it. You're chewing. I don't know the table manners of the alien. Cue the Far Side cartoon. I'm not going to give that one. Look it up. It's awesome. The Far Side is awesome. Yeah, the head bite now does what we see it do in the movies. It attacks the face. It doesn't bite the head off. It doesn't take off the head necessarily, at least. And now it might send the tongue through the eye socket, which, again, really fits. So, yeah. Unlike the second game, the alien predator are not more vocal than, you know, are not very vocal, which in the second game really made you feel like you were one of these. You know, you are a predator, you are an alien, because I should not hit the tripod, because you're hearing those sounds. In this, not so much. I guess it's, again, to avoid, like, when you hear a sound in a movie or a video game, it's always like, okay, can the characters hear that sound, or is that for my benefit entirely? And obviously, it matters whether your character is making a lot of sounds and might be heard by others, but, yeah, it just, it's a, big, it's a huge loss. The wall jump has a yes-no indicator, again, in the reticle, in the crosshairs. So, yeah, you, again, it doesn't always work, but when you try to launch into one, it will tell you, you know, at least might it work. So, yeah. I really do think that the alien jump should just be removed because it's almost entirely useless, and it might just mean that you click it at slightly the wrong time, you know, maybe, yeah, and maybe you just jump instead of wall jumping. And I just feel like if the jump key was specifically for wall jumping, then if you just can't wall jump, then you just don't do anything, you know, same as the grab kill or the use key in single player. Yeah, well, the grab kill is on the use key, if I recall. Yeah, you don't use that much in multiplayer, so maybe I kind of forgot, but yeah. And the when you're wall running, either it's automatic when you touch it or it's on a separate key. In the first one, it's just on a separate key. In the second one, there are keys for both. There is a toggle key that means that when you touch a wall, you will crawl, climb it. And then there is a key that you have to hold down. And it worked both ways, the key that you have to hold down. If you've got wall crawling on, then holding down the on-off will turn it off. Whereas if, you know, wall crawling, if the toggle has been set to off, then holding the button will activate the wall crawling. In this, you have to go out to the controls menu and just find it there, activate it there. That is really, really, it baffles me that they made this decision when they had the opportunity to, you know, when it can be switched back and forth, why not just have a key, a toggle key for, yeah. And you still have no acid spit attack, which, yeah, the alien needs a ranged attack, a proper ranged attack. And in the second one, the pounce did a lot to remedy that. Because, you know, even if you pounce and you don't quite hit the other, you're at least very close to them. You know, now you can only go very close to them. You can't be attacking at the same time. So, yeah, you basically have to just land and then attack. And while you're trying to land, you can be, you know, you can be attacked while you're, so, yeah. The Predator can indeed still leap to and from treetops. And this does, of course, lead to just a few jumping puzzles in single player. So yes, you can still jump very far up into the air, although now you just, yeah, you have to use the focus jumping. And it's a little awkward, and it really feels like it's right out of an action-adventure game, not a first-person shooter, not even really a first-person perspective game. It feels like, yeah, like, excuse me, yeah, like an action adventure, like Commander Keen, because I'm old. Crash Bandicoot, you know, that didn't help much. Yeah, it's actually, does Crash Bandicoot still exist? I haven't played it since like the third one. Yeah. To be fair, I haven't played the first one, so I'm old enough to have to, but to have played. Anyway, yeah. The focus jump means that you have an indicator of where to land. And yeah, basically you use that. It again has a yes-no kind of thing and really easy to read, like crosses for no. So yeah. And I think it's like a circle for yes. So yeah, it's very easy to use. And you can use it to land on any horizontal surface that has enough room on it for you to properly stand. You couldn't land on like a fence, for example. And the treetops, again, especially in multiplayer now, are much more, you know, because of the focus jump, because it's so fast and easy to use, are much more useful. You genuinely can, you know, be using treetops to not only hunt without having been seen, but if you are seen, you can jump between them, jump down from them very quickly. So yeah, it takes about half a second for, you know, you're leaping. So you're like, the moment that you make the decision to leap, which is when you press the jump button, half a second for you to just like, you know, lower your legs, you know, it's a bipedal jump. So, you know, the predator is bipedal. Yeah. So it takes that half a second. I really wish that the alien's lunge basically functions the same way, like the focus jump, that you indicate where you want. Because the aliens, it has to be right in the center of your view. And yeah, I mean, the moment that you then land, then you have to really quickly get your view back to where the enemy is. Because again, if you know, you can't jump directly, you can't use a wall jump to jump directly to the enemy. The focus jumping, which the lunge, allows you to throw yourself directly at an enemy, just not, you know, it doesn't do as much damage as the pounce. But yeah, that is much more close to, I almost said much more closer, so I figured I'd go ahead and actually do. So yeah, you have to be very close for that to be, yeah, whereas, yeah, the predator, the moment he's landed, because you can just put the indicator real close to the enemy, yeah, it takes that half a second, but the enemy might not have time to move that much, or not move enough for a lunge to be, and to be used, and the predator's lunge is much better, much stronger than the alien's. And in general, just, yeah, the... Again, I get why the aliens is the wall jump, because, yeah, it's on four legs, so it is more of a, you know, not the fact that it can jump to a vertical surface, but, yeah, it's like a predatory lunge, like a feline might do, you know. So, yeah, it is directly to where, you know, a leap, you don't necessarily have to, you know, it's not just from, just in a straight line, like, you know, it's, yeah, it's not straight, you know, you can do a diagonal, of course, but, well, no, you'd have to be going straight. Yeah. You, in single player, of course, you can distract with, you know, by throwing your voice, or rather a recorded human voice. And yeah, I think it's really cool that they finally put that in from the movies. And that means that you can generally get close to an enemy without them seeing you, even if it started out with them looking in, you know, maybe in your direction or something. If they haven't seen you, you can distract them. And the, you know, using heat vision is the, if a predator uses heat vision to find another predator, cloak can still make it difficult for them to see. And, you know, marines will be nice and easy to see. I feel like I didn't mention, the alien can sometimes, at limited ranges, see enemies through walls and such, you know, sensing them. So yeah, that makes sense. I did not mean for that pun, I swear. And the heat vision, the Predator 2 movie, the scene in the meat locker, it switches through visions and it uses one that's like teal, That's kind of the one they use here. So it's not the blue one that we're used to from the other movies, from even Prayer 2, as far as I remember, when he's just looking at humans, when he's using heat vision, it's that blue one. The teal one, frankly, strains your eyes, especially early on. It got better, but yeah, again, I just don't see why. They make several changes like this, and I don't really understand why, because they're clearly trying to recreate a lot from the games, from the movies, but then they also make these baffling decisions that make it worse. Don't just make it different, but make it worse. The sentry guns don't look quite right. The combat synthetics look distinctly non, like when you see androids, they look very human, and yeah, in the films. Yeah, just in general, these are not. Yeah, they're. Someone pointed out that the smart gun sounds wrong. Yeah, just a bunch of these changes that. Yeah. Now, you can heal, and it slows you down and is loud and really easy to be found out while you're doing that. In single player, you have to use these, you have to find these things that you then heal with. In multiplayer, it's just energy. I don't know why they didn't just make it energy in single player as well. The Marine has stim packs regardless, that he has to pick up regardless of, yeah. And the heat vision also has this heartbeat that early on had me like checking to see, oh, I must be low on health or something. Not at all. It's just, yeah, it's just there. And again, I don't, it didn't have that effect on me at all in the other games. And I'm not saying there was no, like, but it's just these sounds that seem to be indicating one thing to the player, but are actually indicating something else. I don't know if the sound is all completely work. When the Fox logo comes on at the start of the game, I can see it, but I can't hear it, which is appropriate because I'd rather watch Fox than listen to Fox hosts. So, but the main menu, it sounds like a cell phone is maybe running or something like that. A device is running. And then you're watching like these almost like X-ray kind of images of, yeah, there is like if you start a Predator campaign, it'll be of the Predator, I think. It's been a little while since I really looked at it. The alien, it'll be of the alien, yeah. And it starts out as some. I don't remember which part of the alien life cycle, but yeah. And it just seems, I mean, the Sega logo has sound. The Rebellion logo, of course, it kind of corrodes and explodes at us, kind of smacking us in the face with, "We got your money again. You didn't learn it after Sniper Elite. You didn't learn it from Sniper Elite V2. Sniper Elite Zombie Army." At some point, I mean, how long can they ride on the decent quality of Rogue Trooper and Judge Dredd, Dredd versus Death? And okay, they did get the original AvP game. That one's quite good. The alien. It is a good approach overall, with there now only being two vision modes, and yeah, the aliens are practically invisible in heat vision, and the Marines and Predators are practically invisible in electrical vision, which is for the aliens. And now there's only, you know, there's three visions overall. There's actual regular vision, then there's heat vision, and then there's electrical vision, where, again, the first two had, you know, I don't remember exactly what, it might just be called predator vision. So, yeah, that was four to go, you know, at least the second game has a button that allows you to go backwards, so you don't have to go forwards through, you know, if you want to get to the one just behind or something. But, and this, of course, doesn't have that button, which, I mean, even if there's only three visions, it would still be very useful. I don't know, maybe it's part of trying to make it more even. The Predator is like the Predator of the second movie, you know, Predator 2, with, you know, it's basically a serial killer. If you have a gun, the Predator will kill you, you know, if he has a chance. It's not like in the first, where he's carefully hunting and he takes great care to not... I appreciate that in the second, he's in the city, but right there, it's a bad idea. For the Predator should only be hunting in a... I mean, that's at least something that Predators got, you know, in part of it's just trying to ape the first movie. Yeah. Who hunts in the middle of a city? And that's, of course, why it becomes just a serial killer, you know. I'm not saying it's, you know, I mean, most of the people it kills in Predator 2 are, you know, like, crime, you know, yeah, like these gangs, yeah, LA gang members and such. So, you know, I'm not saying that they're these people who should never... at all. I mean, I'm not in favor of the death penalty or vigilantism, but I'm not saying that it's killing saints, but I don't want to see a hunter go out and, like, butcher. Yeah, serial killer is the term. The Marine still has the motion tracker, and it's still mainly 180 degrees in front of you, but it does sometimes get things behind you, so it has a little bit of the 360 degree. You know, it's like the motion tracker of the movie and, you know, the first two games had a horrible, horrible baby with Primal Hunt. And, yeah... where, you know, the corporates have full 360 degrees, and it's just entirely, you know, it's not quite as far as the 180 degree Marine one, but yeah. And, you know, you're mostly using your shoulder lamp to light your way. In single player, you do have flares where, you know, again, the other two games, you have flares regardless of the mode. And this is like the flares in the first game where, you know, you can throw one, then it'll be a little while, to, you know, there's a cooldown, then you can throw another. You have an unlimited amount. But in the first one, you can throw four without, you know, before you have to cool down. And then, you know, in this, it's only the one. And in the first one, it's also that, you know, when a flare is gone, when it's fully died down, the light from it, then it's, you know, then you can throw another one. I'm not entirely sure if it's in this one. I hardly ever use the flares. Come to think of it, does the first one have a shoulder lamp? Or maybe you can't turn it on or off. I don't remember. It's been a while since I played that one. You can melee at any time. To go into the melee mode, all three species can melee at any time. You never have to put away a ranged weapon to melee. And that, I think, is a great idea. That in the first two, it's just the Predator. Well, in the first one, it's just the prayer. In the second one, the Marine does have a melee weapon, but yeah, there you have to switch away. You have to select your melee weapon, and in this, you can just do it anytime. That I really appreciate. The fact that, because, I mean, it makes sense for the Marine, because he's grabbing another weapon, basically. But in this, he does just, you know, smack the other, you know, with the, it's like the gun butt move. And the Predator is always running around with the wrist plates out, which basically does make sense. You know, the, even if he's not using them, to just have them ready at least, you know. And the ranged weapons for the Predator are on a different key. Well, yeah, the Predator's primary attack doesn't fire a weapon, you know, whereas the Marines, but regardless of the species, you press a different button when you're doing melee attacks than when you're doing ranged attacks. And that is a very good idea. And it was absolutely critical for this game to work at all because of the approach they take. The fights, I am delighted to report, are not like a wrestling match. They're not showy. It's all lethal. You know, again, what the Marine does isn't, you know, lethal, but what can a Marine do that is that lethal against these two? You know, it, for the Marine, it's basically to get them slightly away, you know, hopefully knock them far enough away that they can't melee attack before he shoots them. I really gotta stop hitting the tripod. Or it's, you know, yes, yeah, I'll get into that in mere moments. It's, but anything the alien Predator do is lethal. It's something that could kill. It might not immediately, but it's, yeah, unlike the first AvP film, it is not at all showier like a wrestling match. Yeah, holding down the focus button and then doing a quick attack makes, you know, qualifies, you know, has you do a lunge, which, again, the, yeah, the, only the two non-human species can do focus at all, and thus lunge. And basically, if you lunge or if you counterattack, there is a chance, you know, for the Predator, there's less of a chance if you're doing it to a Predator, but yeah, regardless of the species, there is a chance that you can knock the other person down, which makes it very easy to quickly finish them off before they get back up, although they will get back up in, you know, second and a half. Half a second, something like that. It was kind of too intense for me to time it. And yeah, it also allows you to do a grab kill. And yeah, the system is awkward and simple. It works, but it, yeah, it is kind of awkward. Basically, you know, it's been called rock, paper, scissors, and that fits quite well. The alien and the Predator have heavy attacks, but all three of them can do quick attacks and block. Any quick attack can be blocked, which then opens you up for doing a counterattack on the other person, you know, if you block them. Yeah, any quick attack that you do stops the heavy attack that the other person does, because it's quicker. Any heavy attack beats block, and yeah, that's how it all works. So no matter what, you have a clear idea of the situation that you're, you know, regardless of what move you do. Yeah, and the lunge can be blocked, so yeah. Now, the, which is actually where the alien's lunge really becomes very unfortunate, because the Predator has ranged attacks. So if you're trying to attack a Predator, there's the threat that he's going to cheaply just shoot you rather than engage in melee. And that might force you to try to lunge, to, you know, engage in an attack. Because, you know, if you're not right in front of him, you can't hit him if you're not lunging. Yeah, if not really close. Lunge, you know, kind of closes that distance, but it also attacks, and as such, it can be blocked. And as such, the predator might just block you and then finish you off. So, you know, without it doing, and if the predator is the one to do the lunge and you don't manage to block it, well, actually, that situation's not too bad. But there is always the risk that he's going to do a ranged attack before you do melee. And, yeah, you know, I mean, if they're going to spam the insta-kill move, of course they're willing to, you know, do something as cheap as attack, you know, instead of going for melee, which a predator can often win anyway. Yeah, you know, if neither lunge, then you'll just have, you know, then it'll be quick attack, block, and heavy attack. That's interesting, you know, but yeah, the predator might just, and again, it's usually alien on predator, and, you know, on marine, but the marine can't do that much melee-wise. You know, the marine is basically trying to keep the other two far enough away that he can use his guns, whereas the alien is trying to get so close that, you know, the other's guns won't make a difference. And, yeah. Unlike the second one, this is one of the few times that I will admit that the second one, you know, the ugly trees of the second one are another thing that this improves upon. In this, you can trust your melee weapons. There are not several different animations. When you do a quick attack, it is a quick attack. When you do a heavy attack, it is a heavy attack. And, you know, I already mentioned that, you know, using the tail from the ceiling, you know, from above is much quicker. Otherwise, the tail is always on the heavy attack button. But if you're, you know, above, then it isn't slow. But yeah. In the second game, regardless of which move you do, as the predator, and I think also the alien, it's mainly the predator, I think. Yeah, you can't be absolutely sure what part of the screen he'll hit. You know, you'll want a weapon that hits it, the crosshairs. You know, that's what you want it to do. And in this, it does. And in this, the animations are the same. So you're not waiting for an animation to finish and, you know, hoping that you'll get the good of the animations for the, yeah, I think it's mainly the quick attack for both the wrist blade and the combi stick in the second game that have several animations. I think the heavier attack in that, you know, alternate fire is the same each time. But yeah. The predator has, you know, yeah, the marine and predator have 3 or 4 ranged weapons respectively, and thus have to use, you know, keys 1 through 3 or 4 respectively to switch between them. The marine has alternate fire on all of his weapons, which, you know, yeah, some of those are quite nice. You of course have the pulse rifle, and it looks good, which again, it doesn't really, when you're looking at the pulse rifle from the first person perspective in the second game, the pulse rifle, I don't know what it is about it exactly, but it just looks slightly off. It's the way he's holding it. It looks much better in the first game and in this. And yeah, you can have almost 400 rounds total. And the grenade is the alternate fire, and you can only carry 4 grenades, so use them well. Don't miss, and that also really helps to make the 3 more even. That is your only explosive attack as Marine, so you can't just spot an alien and then just blow it up, you know. Yeah, and the grenades also tend to arc more in flight. In the second game, they almost look like rockets. They just kind of fly directly, and yeah. I think in the movie we didn't get a good enough idea. I don't think it was ever far enough that it had a chance to arc. But yeah, it is very much, again, it makes sense that it would arc, and it also makes it not be unfair. You know, you can't just spot an enemy, you know, 20 meters away and just instantly get them with, you know, your pulse rifle grenade. And, you know, I'm not sure they were unfair. It's been ages since I've been able to play multiplayer in the first two, so I don't remember how even they are in that. But for this, for it to be even, it had to be done like this. You have a flamethrower, of course, and the alternate fire spits out the fuel, and you can then light that on fire with the flamethrower. That's very nice. I must admit, I personally haven't run into a lot of situations where it was immensely useful, but it certainly has a lot of promise. I mean, setting traps and just, yeah, being able to do a little bit more about that distance. You know, if you spit out a little bit of it and then back up and then set that on fire, yeah, you know, I mean, if the enemy is coming right at you, I'm not sure you have that much time to do that. But nevertheless, if you're seeing someone else attacked and you know he's gonna come, he might come for me in a second or two, then you maybe have time for that. Yeah. And you have the auto-tracking smart gun, where the alternate fire is, of course, like in the first two, just manual aim, which can be very useful because it tracks, but it's not immediate, especially in this and the second game. It's not just immediate. So, yeah. And something I do quite like here is that the smart gun is a really effective gun. And as such, and because it's so big, you either carry that or two rifles and then your handgun. That makes a lot of sense, and that is, you know, a typical modern first person shooter trait. You know, in this is somewhat dealt with in the second one in multiplayer by the class system, but anyway, yeah, I don't know. I guess the Rebellion did this game, and Rebellion did the 99 game. We are the 99%. I guess they figured that was a way to win the class, you know, struggle for us. Yeah, this is a really good way to have you, you know, yeah, force you to choose between, and yeah, it also just makes sense. I mean, when you look at the movie, those things are pretty huge. How would you carry something other than your handgun, which, you know, you just, it's your sidearm. It's directly there at your side. Yeah, and I'm not sure you can sprint even if you put the smart gun away, or at least, certainly not if you have it, you know. And, you know, how could they put it away? You do see in the movie that, you know, they don't have to hold it ready to fire. They do have this other way to carry it, which, you know, yeah. So, but that makes a lot of sense, because, you know, you could maybe have, you know, two rifles on your back, but you can't have a smart gun and then a rifle, you know. And again, the pistol is just right there at your side, you know. There's no problem also carrying that. And, you know, the Predator can carry all of his guns at once, but he is also, he has less, and it makes sense. I'll get into why. You have a shotgun, which does indeed fire both barrels as alternate fire. That is incredibly useful for close-up. When you face a Predator in single player, if you're close, again, he might, you know, if he's going in for melee, or he just didn't spot you from far enough away, if you're close, bam, one shot with both, you know, barrels to the face, dead. And there's nothing he can do about, you know, if you surprise him, if you're just green enough, or he's hoping that he can take you with a, you know, I'm almost certain that you can do this as I'm pretty sure that at least once I managed to do this as he was lunging at me. You know, he came right at me with a chainsaw. You all saw it. Directly, fast, claws out, blades out, ready to, and yeah, blew him away. And that is, you know, immensely useful. And then you have the sniper, which has that same advantage, just at range. And it, of course, it's a typical sniper. You know, good at range, good for a few shots, try to hit with the very first shot, otherwise switch to another gun. And it does, you know, I mean, you have the guns that they have in Aliens, the movie, and, you know, one or two more that makes sense. And the you know, in the second one, you have a knife. And that makes sense for, like, close-up. But in this, you know, if they get really close, I mean, if Facehugger comes right at you, you can grab it and get rid of it if you just have enough health. And, you know, I'm not certain that works on, like, the highest difficulty. I didn't play on the highest difficulty, but yeah, that should just not happen. That's something that the first two got perfect. If you are surprised by a facehugger, you die, and that's it. And yeah, and you can block aliens. You know, if they get really close to you, you can, they might actually try to grab you, but again, in single player, you might be able to get them away from you. And that's not even a quick time event. The game just does that automatically, and again, doesn't do that much damage if that's what happens. And just, yeah, it's ridiculous. But anyway, like I said, it basically makes sense why these are the guns. However, this means that the game only has 6 guns for the Marine. The first one had 8, the second one had 10. And in, you know, in both of them, you have, like, a minigun. You can use, like, mines from your grenade launcher, you know, proximity mines. And you have a rocket launcher, and, you know, and either that has, or there's also a weapon that has heat-seeking rockets. You know, it's just, that's a lot to lose. And, you know, again, I get it. That, you know, wouldn't be quite fair for multiplayer, but it just seems to me like it's a lot to lose is all. I again, if they just did it with the class system, then you could have, I mean, an enemy, you know, a Marine who's only running around with an RPG and a few, you know, outside of the situations where the RPG is extremely useful, it is actually a bit of a burden, you know, literally. And yeah, I mean, I get it. I get why you don't want players running around and getting both, like, a smart gun and a pulse rifle, you know, and the RPG, because then they're extremely difficult for the other players, you know, whether at range or close up. But yeah, class system. And the Marines' guns are just not powerful enough. Again, others have pointed this out. And it makes it really difficult, even when facing just a few aliens, And then you, of course, have that your pistol has infinite bullets. The alternate fire is burst mode, but yeah, I get why, but again, just not something that you should be doing. And I've heard that at the end of a level, it switches them to level defaults. Again, that must be on a higher difficulty setting than I played on, because that didn't happen to me. But yeah, frustrating, but I can also understand why it's, you know, that is one way to make a game more difficult. But yeah, I do prefer when there's kind of an explanation, like, only if you're, you know, From when you end one level and start another, there's usually a bit of time, and a lot of the levels start either with you surprised that you're there, or maybe you had to ride a motorcycle to get there. And realistically, how do you put a lot of how do you carry a lot of weapons on your person and drive a motorcycle in any kind of effective way, you know? So yeah. And that game also really allowed for good melee for the player character, the human player character. The Predator's weapons include, of course, the beloved plasma cannon, the shoulder cannon. And where in the first game and the movies, it kind of burns through enemies. You know, it burns through what it hits. In the second game, it kind of blows stuff up, which I kind of get, because otherwise the Predator doesn't have a lot of, you know, explosive and splash damage kind of weapons, but it's still, yeah. This, it's kind of a mix. It, you know, it's not going to do a lot of damage to you unless you're really, really close to the blast. Where, you know, again, in the second one, you can blow yourself up if you're not careful. But, yeah. And you can charge it to do more damage. You can also fire it, you know, really quickly. You can fire it, I wouldn't say blindly, it basically to where it just goes where the crosshairs were pointed at that time, you know. And yeah, you use the laser to indicate where you want it to go, and if you're holding it down, like, you know, charging and waiting for the triangles, then it will actually keep the laser there rather than just put them there the one time that you press the, you know, ranged attack key. And yeah, the lasers can give you away, much like the movies and the first two games. And the triangle will gradually form, you know, over a few seconds. I really like how they did it here. I quite like how they did it here. It makes sense, and it's not too fast, it's not too slow, which again was sometimes a problem in the first two. And the, you know, any ranged attack as the Predator, you can hold it down, and then when you release it, it'll fire. And actually, possibly not the disc. Anyway, yeah. And if you do so, you can always cancel. There, you know, yeah. And it's entirely dependable. And if you're standing and, you know, you're charging, you're very slow. And yeah, so, you know, don't do that just any time, because it's dangerous. And if the triangle fully formed, the projectile will indeed follow. So yeah. You also have the spear, which is now purely for throwing. And, you know, it moves slightly slowly, but it does a lot of damage. And it has a cooldown for, yeah, you know, rather than you having to, like, pick it up, which is, you know, like, yeah, you don't pick up any ammo in this as the Predator. And, you know, you pick up weapons the first time you find them, but that's it. And the disc, which will indeed boomerang and ricochet following your laser, so yeah. And it does, yeah, it's very effective and you know, painful, and it moves at roughly the speed of a boomerang, you know. So yeah, the moment you throw it, if someone else comes, you know, attacks you from another side, you maybe want to go into melee or something. And yeah, you kind of have to melee as the Predator now. And yeah, with how simple it is, it does get monotonous, especially because, I mean, at least the alien can do it from, like, any surface and jump between surfaces. The Predator, he has to be on, you know, he can't even be on a vertical surface. And Yeah, you have to melee a lot of the time. Where again, before you could, yeah, it's just there are too few weapons for it not to get monotonous. It's too streamlined a game for it not to get monotonous. And yeah, you do now have, as you might have seen in trailers and such, four wrist blades that are about half an arm long, because that isn't excessive or anything. I know that some of the newer movies have gone, really far in that direction. They did it really well in the first game. They did it perfect in the second game, and now we have these ridiculously long ones, and also on both wrists. And I get it. It's because when he blocks, he does, the kind of the Wolverine stance for that. Other than ripping off Wolverine for that, why not have something else in the left hand? This is the first time in one of the games that it's on both. Yeah, and why not a dagger? I get that you have to be able to block with it, but how about holding a dagger like this and then maybe holding it, like this, with the blade here the rest of the time? That would make the quick attack have some more interesting, as it is, it's just, hitting the other person with the wrist blades, which is also the heavy attack. Maybe like, yeah, stabby, or with the dagger, or like a quick cut across something that isn't just that very basic. I mean, again, like I said, you can't trust your melee weapons in the second game, especially the claw, the quick attack of the claw, but at least it has more than the one animation. I would prefer if they had picked just one of those animations and then purely gone with that. But yeah, those animations are more interesting than just attacking the, yeah. There's just not enough content here, and it's really, it wouldn't have been that difficult to have more and to make more work. And the you now have proximity mines, which have a nice radius, other than, you and Marines can shoot it to detonate it without a big explosion, but it is so big that if an alien detonates it, it's almost sure to kill them. Certainly, the only way I've found as an alien to be able to detonate them without dying is to, already know where they are and have to sprint past it, which is, that's the fastest way the alien can move, like, consistently. It can sprint for a longer time than it can, wall jump. And yeah, sometimes that will still kill you, and that's frustrating when some predator players choose to spam and camp with that. And that, again, it wouldn't be difficult. It just, if a predator stays within a small area and puts mines around it, I don't remember which game it was, but here's the solution for that. If someone's camping, kill the player and just tell them, you camped. That's it. That, when that first happened, it was like, well, there's a solution for that. That's, yeah, exactly. Because nobody likes campers. Campers don't like camping or campers. Campers are just cheap and or bad players who do it like, it's kind of like, when you've just been growing up with, and you're like having ice cream. It's a way to deal with the problem in a way that doesn't actually solve the problem. When if you actually, instead of camping or eating ice cream, just grab a gun and go out there and deal with it. That's the better approach. Now, the proximity mines, They stick to any surface, which is quite nice, but they are the kind of claymore design from Requiem, other than the much better, much cooler looking ones from the second game. I'm not saying they should copy the second game. I'm saying go in the direction of the second game. Make up a third, look for them instead of just, I don't necessarily mind it that much in Requiem because for one thing, the movie has to identify it to us. We have to know what it is that was just set up. And yeah, for that, it makes sense to design them in a way that looks like ours, something that we recognize as that, because otherwise it could be any number of things that he just put there. So yeah, but it's a game and you don't have to visually identify things. It's yeah. And like the other ranged attacks, he just has infinite of them. And he charges them with the energy, and that's how, the proximity mines and the shoulder cannon both require energy. And of course, when you run out of energy, you then have to actually get more energy, and that can that prevents you from using those two ranged attacks. But that apparently means that he's just carrying just, I don't know, hundreds, I guess, theoretically, if you keep charging, I mean, especially in single player, if you just keep throwing and then just charging up and using more, I mean, well, let's go with dozens at least. He's apparently carrying dozens of these things. It's a decent enough idea that when he grabs one, as you're about to place one, you can either just drop it or you can charge it up. And yeah, and it's like with the other ones for the charging. And even if you just throw it, he will, you see him charge it with a little energy before he throws it. So that's kind of, oh, and the explosion is also an energy explosion. It's not a fireball. So that's how they work, and that's how they aren't like activated the moment an enemy moves up on him. That's what gives them their, that's what charges them, that's what arms them. And yeah, that part of it makes sense, but yeah, I mean, is he apparently carrying just infinite of them? Does he have a machine we never see that generates them right before he charges them? It raises too many questions. And it's, again, multiplayer always raises questions. It's like, why is this the, why are they in this arena? Why can't they get out? How did they even get in here? And is, why are there all these respawning ammo pickups? But at least they're ammo pickups. At least you're picking up something explosive, for example, so that it kind of sort of makes sense. But just having infinite, just, yeah. And the, you know, but yeah, the streamlining for the Predator here, it basically makes sense. And he's not a tank. He's not carrying 10 weapons, some of which are big at the same time, and moving around at, he can still leap in the second game even carrying those 10 weapons. That's pretty ridiculous, no matter how strong his leg muscles are. That may, how is he even having all of them on his person and still moving, like not constantly? Yeah, it's pretty ridiculous. But and same for the Marine. But again, the class system made sense, and that way you could switch between all of these different weapons, so that you aren't, you could switch between classes so that there was more variety to it. But yeah, it does also help here for both the Prayer and the Marine to switch very easily between them. And you could argue that the Predator shouldn't have to walk around picking up ammo that, he has. Yeah. Once he has a weapon, it works, you might say. He doesn't really have to, that's why the healing also requires energy. Everything that requires something, doesn't take ammo in this, but, you know, for the predator, but energy. So, yeah, you know, that basically makes, you know, you could make an argument that they wouldn't carry ammo, that they just have, yeah, or pick up ammo during the hunt, something like that, sure. But it does end up with the predator in this only having 5 weapons, only 4 of them ranged, only 3 of them ranged, like, you know, project, you know, where you're throwing something. I mean, the proximity mine is essentially for traps. It's not something that you use when you're facing an enemy, you know. So, yeah, and in first game, the predator has 6 weapons total, and the second, he has 8. You know, in both of those, you have the spear gun and a pistol that does, you know, that, you know, causes splash damage. And there's an example of, you know, redesigning. The pistol looks completely different in the 2 games. And, yeah, so it wouldn't have been hard to make another design for the proximity mine. But, yeah. Yeah, and, you know, in the second game, you also have the net gun and the... It's not technically proximity mine, it's remote bomb in the second one, which, you know, again, useful for traps. And for that, I do appreciate that they didn't just copy the weapon that, you know... And this is also the first of the 3 where you can throw the spear. In the second one, you can only use it as, you know, kind of like a bow staff or something, and... Yeah, and to be fair, in the movie, we do also see him throw it. I'm a little bit blanking on, I feel like he also uses it when it's in his hand, but there's at least one time where the predator throws the spear in order to, you know, yeah, to use it as a weapon. I realize about the plot, there are things that the player experiences that are like, oh, that character from that movie experienced that too. But it's like, oh, right, that character died from it. And the fact that they have it happen to the player character and that he survives just makes that species seem weak, that event seem weak. You know, the face-hugging is an example of that. And, you know, when you get jumped by, we're talking, the alien will basically just mount you if yeah, and you can still not, and the player character will still knock it off, you know, as a marine. And yeah, it's just, if you want to do something like that, if you want to do it from a first person perspective, have another character see that through a first-person perspective. Have another character experience through a first-person perspective, and don't tell the player that they're not the character. A little bit of a cheat, maybe, but it's better than what they do here. You know, just have the first thing the player as the Marine sees be this just, you know, mayhem of aliens and facehuggers, and heck, maybe even make it a, you know, someone that you as the player have to guide around, and then ended with him being face hugged or something, and then pull out and show that wasn't the player character. Although in this you can barely tell they do a decent job with the alien. I'm not sure I should give away how, but the Marine, I didn't even know what he looked like until the ending, when it actually gives us a third person perspective. But yeah, it would have been easy to just, you know, then the next time you see a character, just, you know, show the face and then pull into that with the camera, and then you are the player character, you know. Yeah, something like that, you know. That is something that is okay to do every so often. Certainly in movies, you can have a character seem like they're going to be important and then have them killed off. So it's like, you know, yeah. And I want to say I've seen that done in games before, but I'm not 100% sure. I've sort of already said this, but yeah, this is developed by Rebellion, who also developed the original, and unlike Sierra, who developed the far superior second game, superior to this and the first. And yeah, you can tell. As others have pointed out, there are a lot of poor design choices and an overall lack of quality to this. The controls can be quite clumsy. This does not come close to meeting expectations. There's repetitive design, and you know, it lacks the attention to detail, the well-considered level design, and the sense of momentum that makes great first-person shooters, that makes really memorable ones. These set pieces are underwhelming, and you know, yeah, there aren't enough of them. Some have said that it's downright broken. Some of the time, yes, but it's actually, I guess that does mean it's broken. It's, yeah, it's a little broken. It's not hugely broken, but yeah, you know, like I said, the wall crawling just does not always work. And, you know, it's incomplete. I don't know why. This doesn't have any... Yeah, I would say I don't want to spoil the plot. You pretty much, you know what's, you know, that's something all others also said, is predictable plot. You know what's going to happen 5 minutes into this. Everything that, yeah, you can, yeah, the twists are so obvious. And yeah, there isn't pilot technology in this. The space jockey, nowhere in this. It was in the first game. The second game has, you know, the first game just has it there because it was in one of the films. So yeah, you know, at least one. I don't want to spoil. The second game actually explores a little without taking away the mystique of the species, you know, Prometheus. And this just doesn't have any. I don't understand why. It's not like they couldn't have had it. It's not like this being tied very clearly to the two Alien vs. Predator movies, you know, somehow retcons the pilot. The movies don't retcon the... It baffles me. They, you know, everybody loves the, you know, again, until Prometheus, everybody loves the space jockey and the pilot technology. Yeah. This has an unending, just the menus never end. I cannot, it's amazing. Of all the things they streamlined, they forgot that one. I can't remember when I was last in a game where the menus were so bad. I you know, I should like say, oh, they haven't been this bad since, but you know, when you go back to old games, I mean, you could argue that they didn't have as much to adjust and such. Well, argue, that is true, but nevertheless, I'm not sure I've played any game that had as many menus as this. You just endlessly go, you can't go into a multiplayer game without going through, I want to say maybe 4 or 5 menus. I'm sorry, but that's ridiculous. I don't know if the developers realize this, but there are games where you can click one button where you're in the main menu, you click like quick match or something, and you're in a multiplayer game, and that's it. Yeah, it's just, yeah. The AI. The others have already pointed out, the Marines show no emotion when one of their, you know, when another human has just, you know, when they find the body of a human being having been, you know, brutally murdered, they don't mind that at all. I wonder if maybe it's to make the stealth easier, you know, comparing it to the first two Arkham games, the only two that I've played. I'm not saying those are bad, but in those, I mean, they're infinitely better than this. Yeah, in those two games, when you take out an enemy with stealth, he will be left there. You know, you might leave him hanging off a gargoyle or something, and that's how that go. And then the other enemies see him, and it's, you know, you're Batman. You're spreading fear in the people who spread fear. You're making the criminals afraid, you know. So yeah, that it makes a lot of sense and it really works. But in the movies, the you know, yeah, it's not like, I mean, sometimes sometimes they do manage to hide what they're doing, but the creatures, but the it's not. When they kill someone and leave them there, it's not like, you know, that, yeah, the other humans actually react to that. But yeah, I figure it's to make continued stealth a little easier or something. But yeah, it's a bad decision. Half of the time, the alien AI is really stupid. But they do tend to, you know, attack and then retreat and, you know, use the walls to hide and to come at you from a different direction and such. And, you know, yeah, it's and that's also a good idea to do when you're playing as an alien. If, you know, if at all there's if you attack and they might survive, it's maybe a good idea to get, you know, to hide or get, you know, yeah, move so you're attacking from a different direction or something. And yeah, it does very much force the marine and predators, single player and multiplayer alike, to look above and to all, you know, to all sides, all directions often. And yeah, if you don't, you die really quickly. And that, honestly, that wasn't quite accomplished by the first two. This doesn't have them randomized in single player, which the first does, which does really help that. But the, you know, it also doesn't have them move stiffly and obviously, like in two. The big thing with two, as far as alien AI is, once you've played the single player campaign as a species, other than adjusting the difficulty setting, the aliens will never surprise you, nor will the others. But the aliens, you really expect to be surprised by them, and just never happens. And yeah, you know, I yeah, if you play like far enough apart, you might forget, but it's just yeah. And in neither of them are they anywhere near as dangerous as they are here. And that, you know, again, I'm especially talking about when there's a group of them. If there isn't a group of aliens, then it's difficult. Maybe that should have been part of it. Maybe in multiplayer, it should just have been that there's always just a few more, you know, for every third, you know, yeah, every time there's three players in each of them, then there's one more alien. Just, you know, just a little bit so that, because one alien by itself is just not that effective. And yeah, in anyway, yeah, that is quite nicely done in, you know, in this, as far as the, you know, AI goes. And that is, yeah, but again, that's only half the time. The other half, they do come right at you, or they suddenly forget to move, or yeah. This does somewhat build to the stronger enemies, and it does send a fitting amount of them towards you, but the boss battles are uninspired, forgettable, and I am baffled by the choice of some of the. Yeah, I don't want to give it away, but yeah, I would be surprised surprised if there were very many people who played this and weren't like, what? When they see some of these boss battles, and yeah. As I've maybe already sort of said, but just to make sure it's said, to an extent, this does have the look, you know, this, yeah, this look, sounds, and feels like the films, but unfortunately some of that is like the two Alien vs. Predator films, rather than the, you know, the good ones, or even the, yeah, just the main Alien and Predator films. And yeah, this doesn't particularly convince you of the world like the second did. The music is pretty good. And like the second game, fire looks nicer than the first, but it's just nowhere near as scary as the first. It takes a lot to kill an alien. And that's the thing, in the first, even a civilian could be very dangerous to you, because he might have a Molotov and he might drop it out of fear if you, you know, when you approach him. So you may have to get just close enough and then speed away in the opposite direction to wait until the fire hits and dies back out. If you catch fire in the first game as an alien, you are basically dead. The best case scenario is maybe there's some water nearby, or maybe you just barely will have time to get some food out of a downed enemy. That, otherwise, that's it. And yeah, it's fire. It should be. I mean, if you want to adjust that, maybe make the flamethrower hold less ammo, or maybe make it not quite a flamethrower, but just something that can provide a little bit of fire. Like, can't you like make a makeshift tiny flamethrower from like a lighter and some hairspray? I feel like I heard that once. I didn't do it, and I certainly didn't burn someone's hair off. And yeah, it's just, yeah. I feel like that, you know, okay, yeah, that's not a huge range, but, and it's not going to last very long, but if it set the alien on fire, and the alien would pretty much die from being on fire, how do you survive being on fire? I know the alien can survive a lot, but it's fire. I mean, you wouldn't necessarily die as the predator, but that's because if you get out his healing thing and then right click, he, you know, puts out the fire. And, you know, that makes sense. He has something in all that armor or, you know, equipment that puts out fire. You know, that's not huge, but what's the alien gonna do? And I mean, if fire isn't that scary in a series that where it used to be just terrifying, yeah. And you have a mission selector in this with four difficulty settings, and you get to set it before every, you know, no matter the mission. And the moment that you've completed one mission, you can then play the next mission, and then at any time. I already mentioned that I played the first Marine level first, so as to best be able to review it and remember the different species. I chose not to play through any of the campaigns before any of the others. I played a Marine level, then a Predator level, then an Alien. I don't remember the exact order, but that kind of thing. So yeah, so I still distinctly remember the endings of all three and the final level. And yeah, you don't have to, you know, you can take breaks from campaigns, play other parts of, you know, other campaigns, and go back, and you'll still be able to play that level. And I think there's also save slots. I didn't use them much because it also has checkpoint saving, so why even particularly bother? Near the end, I did try to save and see if that necessarily made a difference. I don't know. I guess it makes sense that if you, if you get to a certain checkpoint or level and then you save to a file and then you start playing a different level, then you can still load that one without losing having gotten to that checkpoint. That makes sense. Yeah, something like that. And there will be some challenge even on the lowest difficulty setting. However, between the checkpoint saving and the infinite ammo pistol and, yeah, somewhere along the line, the game stopped being scary. There is, the panic is what is one of the best features of the original game. It is utterly, yeah, it's nightmare inducing. It is panic just, and yeah, and it just works. And that is also one of the things that, there are a lot of different monsters in cinema, but one of the things that both of these can do that are very, very distinct about them and that not all can, you know, really pride themselves on having is panic. They're, yeah, you don't know where they're going to come from, you don't know when they're going to attack, and you know that if they attack, when they attack, because they're going to attack, you might not live, because they're just that deadly. And that is completely lost in this one, especially in the single player. And, yeah, it's, well, yeah, in the single player, but, yeah, it's a huge, even if, you know, this is not made for its single player, it's clearly for the multiplayer, but, and I'll get to the multiplayer and why that one isn't that good either. But yeah, just if you're going to have single player at all, have it be just a little bit, just something. Yeah, just not terrible. And yeah, you can also only carry 4 healing items. Like you can only carry 4 pulse rifle grenades, which again really helps make it, yeah. You know, and I do think that it's overall a good idea to give healing items to the Marine, because this is the first time he's had making them, giving him some healing items that he can carry, because before he just had to find it. And yeah, I do think that's a good, yeah, way to do that. And the, yeah, like the second one, there's just really no replay value. It's linear. There's no real randomization. This does have collectibles and, you know, points and such, but it's just, I mean, even I already mentioned that within minutes of the Marine campaign, I had so many questions. I was also bored. It's just so boring, because almost immediately, within a few minutes, you've tried everything the game has to offer for that species. So once you've played a few minutes of each species, you've tried everything that has to offer. And that, yeah, that just shouldn't be the case. I mean, say what you will about, like, Left 4 Dead, there's no, like, XP, there's no RPG elements. There are still a lot of different situations, because every special infected leads to a different situation. And if that special infected attacks when you're at low health or at high health, maybe it attacks around the time another special infected attacks. And maybe you're in a certain area that is very distinct. You know, if you're close to, like, cars, the tank is especially dangerous, for example. Or if you're a tight area, the tank is almost impossible to get, you know. And the charger is far more, you know, and the second one, far more impactful than, you know, in like a corridor or the like, than more out in the open. And all of these things, and in this, they're just not really, yeah, they're not that, there's not that much here. And the, yeah, the collectibles for all 3 species have these really dumb explanations. Like, I believe the queen ones, it's like the alien ones, it's like queen saliva or something like that, that like the human researchers they extracted and they've placed different. It's just, it's so dumb. I mean, I know they drool a lot, but bringing attention to that in a game just doesn't seem like that good of an idea to me. And the Predators ones, they're like these trophy like bags or something. They're used to like mark really good hunting grounds. So why are they all on this one planet? And should I really be picking them up? Because now we don't know that that was a good place to hunt anymore. It's just dumb. And it's, how about this specific area has a unique, I don't know, maybe it has some kind of plant life that is unique to that area and that the predator might use to mark something, or I don't know, but you know, then you do that, something. And the marine, it's audio logs. Audio logs are often just okay. The ones in Fear, the Fear trilogy, are just okay. I've heard that there are some really bad ones. This, they're amazing in System Shock 1 and 2. They're horrible in this. I don't even know how you do something this poorly. Sometimes they state the obvious, sometimes they're just utterly uninteresting. The acting tends to be really bad. They just feel like an afterthought. And yeah, there's no single player unlockables and few multiplayer unlockables. And again, you know, multiplayer unlockables have nothing to do with single player. And yeah, you do get a rating. And a, you know, both in points and in like name after you've completed level, but you have nothing to compare it to. So what's the point? I don't know, I guess like if you played again, I don't even know if I haven't replayed any levels and I really don't intend to. I guess if maybe if you replay, then you'll be like they'll be the same. You know, maybe it'll show more. Maybe when you completed the level, it'll say this, you know, previous score, new score, something like that. But the first time, it's just whatever. And why would you replay it when it's this boring? Now, the all three, you know, species are capable, but not all of their campaigns are easy, but still, like the second one, it ends up too easy. You're just too powerful. You know, the first game, on the other hand, makes you feel really weak, regardless of who you're playing as, but still. And while the ugly trees are gone, this has really awkward, obvious, you know, like natural geographical magazines. You know, like rocks and such that are like really obviously, okay, you're supposed to go this way now, you know. And yeah, the all three have the same small six small levels. The order varies, but yeah. It's recycled. You even go to some of the exact same areas. And, you know, there's the thing of, oh, this, you know, maybe this character breaks something and this other character fixes or uses that or, you know, but yeah, it's just, they're not different enough. At the end of the day, it's first person perspective. They are moving in a linear fashion and they're killing everything in their path. And yeah, it's just, you know, if one of them maybe flew, or if you got to play as a facehugger or something, that would make it very different. You know, the facehugger really has to avoid, you know, others at all times. And that's, you know, part of the fun of the, yeah. The, just, too much of these are the same. They're too similar. And, I mean, basically, we have two first-person perspective stealth games, and then, you know, one of which almost can be played like a first-person shooter, and then one full first-person shooter. They're not different enough. They're not interesting enough playing experiences. You know, the second game has some of the same overall places, but you're in new areas, or you're maybe like... There's a point where the Marine walks through like this skyway kind of thing. The Predator is walking on top of it, you know, and they might not even be walking through or on top of the same one. It's just that, you know, when you play both, you're like, oh, right, this overall area, because they're in the same overall facility. So, yeah, of course, they're in the, you know, and some of the areas seem like this, like, maybe both use some elevators that look like the same and such, but there's one bit where the three of them are in basically the same area. That's it. And that's purely to have that really cool bit of the meeting. I mean, here they never actually meet, which, you don't have to do that, but it's just, They are straight up recycling the levels, and it's just, it feels really lazy. Like, in the first game, the bonus levels were the campaign levels of the other two, and they would more or less evenly distribute them, and, you know, most of them you only play as one of the other species, you know. And, I mean, that had the fun of giving, you know, because the alien can walk all the walls, so, you know, what does the Marine do? What does the Predator do? The Marine gets a jetpack, and the Predator gets a grappling hook, and that's just awesome. And you only unlock all five of the bonus levels if you play... It's not a secret that there are five. The moment you've... Yeah, it's not a secret. You have to complete every single campaign level of that species in order to unlock all five, you know, bonus levels. And you can't just, like, complete, you know, the first several levels on, like, the easiest, or even the second, you know, next to hardest. You can only play a level on the same... level of difficulty that you completed the level before it on. That's it. So, yeah. And that is, and again, those are bonus levels. Those aren't main story levels. It's just unbelievably lazy. You do encounter a hive complete with eggs, and in single player, also cocooned humans, and maybe you'll have to mercy kill someone. And also in single player, yeah, there will be a queen complete with egg sac. The levels are decently varied, but you don't spend enough time to really get a strong, you know, memory of any of them. None of them are amazing, which, you know, yeah, there are amazing, unforgettable levels in both of the first games. Now, the multiplayer, it gets it gets mayhem right. And again, it's limited by not having a class system. You know, different people say different things about how balanced it is. Overall, I would say it is fairly balanced. Now, the multiplayer is clearly why this even exists. And I guess overall, if just... Yeah, overall, sure, it... You know, you can get it, and it has a reason to exist for that. You know, I tend to say that any piece of creative expression has to, you know, it maybe kind of has to talk the, you know, us into give us a reason why it exists. And I'm not saying that, you know, if it doesn't, that it's automatically bad. I'm not saying that, you know, yeah, but nevertheless, I do think that, yeah, you know, like, if this didn't have multiplayer at all, this game would not have a reason to exist. And, you know, because in that case you might, you know, yeah, just play the first two. But, yeah, you can unlock additional skins via XP, you know, 6 for the Marine, 6 for the Predator, including one that shows some forehead in spite of having a mask, and 4 for the Alien, including the player character Alien and a Praetorian, which, you know, it's only Praetorian in appearance. It's not actually, yeah. There, I have encountered a little bit of lag. There is no automatic team balancing. If you, you know, if players, if there's a match and there's team balancing, it's because the players are doing that. And, you know, there's no vote kick, although I have encountered some matches where, like, the rules will be very specific and, you know, it would kick people who spam the shoulder cannon, for example. And some say that, you know, like, if the host quits, you're, you know, then all the XP is lost and stuff. I feel like that's, those are reviews of back when it didn't have dedicated servers. And that's also something, if you're going to play this in multiplayer, you know, don't be fooled by, you know, if you go and player hosted, you can sit there and wait for ages. There might not be any, just choose dedicated servers. That, there are still, you know, sometimes only like 2 with, you know, actual players on it. And, you know, you can't filter away the empty ones, the full ones, the password protected ones. But thankfully, it does have the, I don't know, bars, I guess. So if you double click on the player one, it will put at the top the ones that have players on them. So you don't have to scroll through all of those. So yeah. And the, since there are so few servers, the more, you know, as it is in this, it's, you know, the fun modes are rare, you know. The less servers a multiplayer game has, the more it's going to be just deathmatch and other vanilla. Yeah. Sometimes it plays a lot like Left 4 Dead 2, you know, you're covering angles and, you know, keeping close eye on your, you know, your allies and such. Sometimes it feels like a first-person shooter with aliens. Sometimes it feels like a first-person perspective beat-em-up fighting game, you know, of the simple variety with Marines. Yeah, it's a little uneven, is what I'm getting at. And if you're great at first-person shooters, but you're not good at fighting games, you will have trouble with this game. And yeah, the Marine spawns with only the infinite ammo pistol and the pulse rifle, which, you know, makes sense as, you know, you're just being stationed or whatever, and you can fight back, but you will want a bigger gun, you know. And the Predator spawns with no ranged weapons, which is a lot like the first AvP movie, where, you know, I suppose I shouldn't give that away, but yeah, there's a similar element there. And it just, again, helps to even things out, because the ranged attack is one of the things that the Predator has that almost, I'm not saying it shouldn't have a ranged attack, I'm saying that it should maybe be a little less powerful than it is. So, you know, make it more like the Alien. And, you know, people are gonna scream about, well, in the movies, yeah, but they still have to make it a good game. They have to change some things for that. Now, picking up ammo for the Marine means finding those guns. There are no, like, caches of ammo. And it is very much first come, first served. So, yeah, make sure to get a good gun or you might be stuck with, yeah. And though you cannot choose which species or team you're, you know, yeah, inside the match. You can always jump out of the match, jump back in, and you know it'll reset the score, but that's about it. You can then choose whoever you want, and that's how team balancing happens. And of course it doesn't always happen. Sometimes it just means that suddenly there's almost no one in one of the three teams, and but you know, if you find yourself on a team that has almost no one, and you're like, the other teams have ton of players, I'm gonna join one of those, it's very easy to do. And this allows you to join in progress, and when you join, you get to choose between, you know, one of the three species, again, regardless of how many there are on the various teams. And you can see the, you know, how many are on what teams, how many of the three species are there, because that will always be the same. And you know, you can get an actual server list. You can also, you know, say a quick match, although I'm not sure I've ever had much. I tend to find that the best results come from getting the server list for the dedicated servers. And I'm not entirely certain. I don't know, you probably can quick match even. I think I only tried quick match from the, you know, player hosted, but And you can also create a match, which I didn't really, I only did that for like player host, I guess that is the only, I know that on dedicated matches they had other things, it seemed, but if you create a match, you get to choose the mode, the map, the amount of players, the amount of private slots, you know, set a password or leave it empty for none, you set the time limit, the score limit. And when you're looking at servers, you can see, you know, the teams up to all three, whether or not balancing is, I'm pretty sure there was a yes, no for that. I guess it's always no. I didn't really look too much. I never experienced team balancing other than manual. And, you know, whether a friendly fire is on and whether it's a custom match. And you cannot change the rules. They are set in stone. And you know, in you used to be able to set like the number of rounds and how many points the different, you know, how many points it would get to kill another player. And you know, how many rounds, because maybe you do want to play more than one match in the same map. You know, if it's, it's only the host who gets to choose the map. So, and sometimes it's just, it's fun if the same players get to first do, you know, first be in one of the two situations and the next round the other of the two situations, so you can really clearly like so you get both experiences. And you know, you get to, you can set weapons to on or off, sometimes equipment as well. In the first one, you can set how many lives people have, and even if they're shared, or you know, just if each player has that amount of lives, and just a ton of more variety. And this has something called persecution, which is a lot like Max Payne 3's Vendetta. I don't play a lot of these shooters in multiplayer, or shooters, you know, modern shooters in general, but I haven't really seen it outside of these two games. I'm sure it is in other games. I think it should be in pretty much every, you know, every first person shooter, every third person shooter that has multiplayer. The basic idea is if you're, you know, if you're killed by the same guy a lot of times, a certain amount of times probably, there's a skull placed over his head and you take revenge by killing him. And yeah, you know, in, and it makes sense, you know, you were being persecuted or you, excuse me, you know, he had a vendetta against you, you have now have a vendetta against him, and then you got revenge for the persecution because, you know, the different species can persecute even members of their own species. And, you know, yeah, you solved that vendetta if you killed them, you know, that makes a lot of sense to, yeah. Now, if you want single player with Alien, Predator, and Marine, play the first game, play the second game, you know, for multiplayer. There aren't a lot of servers for the first game. I mean, it's on like GOG, like GOG Galaxy. I haven't found many servers. And the second one, I think you can maybe play it if you use like mods or patches. So yeah, you know, for that, play Left 4 Dead 2 instead. It's much more varied and interesting. Now for the modes, the Survivor co-op allows 1 to 4 Marines to face waves of progressively stronger waves of AI controlled aliens. And, you know, in some ways this is version 2.0 of the, you know, that mode in the first game. However, this one is limited to 4 and you can't play it as a Predator. Yeah. One of the maps actually opens up and, you know, lets you get your hands on more guns and such, but that's it. The rest of them don't actually open up, even though, again, if you're gonna either don't do it or do it more than once, because it just shows that, yeah, there's more that I'm gonna get into of that, but yeah, it just shows that you can do it. And I just, how difficult is, I kept looking at the doors expecting one of them to open after the various waves, you know. It just, yeah. And there's apparently also, like, you can only play it for 1 hour before it ends, and yeah. Now, it does adjust how many aliens there are, specifically by how many players there are, so that's good. And you can play it just by yourself, you know. Now, if you don't download any maps, there's only 2 maps for it. And even for that, they couldn't do it with both. They couldn't have both of them open up. Only one of the two, yeah. Now, the maps for it tend to be pretty decent. The, you know, they're open-ish and not, you know, not like too many narrow corridors, so the Marine has a leg to stand on. But at the same time, they're typically inside and they're like in relatively tight quarters still. So yeah, the alien, and you know, there's a lot of darkness, there are a lot of vertical and horizontal surfaces. Yeah, there's some really, yeah, it works really well for both species, giving something that both can, yeah. Now, Predator Hunt, you know, the one player at random at first is selected, you know, and given 80 seconds, you know, that's the default to hunt and kill Marine players. And he gets, I think it's like 50 or 60 seconds for each Marine player he kills. And if a Marine kills the Predator, the two switch places, and if the time just passes without anyone killing the Predator, another is just selected at random. You know, not unlike like the tank in Left 4 Dead, yeah, versus. So yeah, that's quite nicely done. He can't just camp. Now, see, they do know how to deal with campers. Yeah, and, you know, the predator spawns, of course, without ranged weapons, and with every player gunning specifically for him. So he has to make the choice whether to carefully try to get, and relatively quickly, because the clock is ticking, a ranged weapon, or whether to jump into melee with enemies who are constantly looking for him and have guns. You know, again, every Marine spawns with, you know, the pistol, which does have infinite ammo, and the pulse rifle. And it doesn't take that much to kill a predator, especially one that, you know, can't do much other than move and attack. You know, it can, you know, leap far and relatively fast, but it's still easy to shoot. And, you know, the Marines can very easily just clump together and, you know, check those corners. And, of course, the motion tracker distinguishes between, you know, friendlies and not, which makes that and the infestation mode much less fun. And again, just have a rule for this. Have an on-off thing that, you know, maybe can be voted on. It's not that hard. Now, this mode is also in the first game, and so it's an alien version. In the second game, you can pick between all... You can pick between four different for both of these sides. You know, you can, you know, then that's because there are two human factions, the Marines and then the corporates. And the corporates have different, you know, have some equipment that, not so much in Alien Whisperer 2, but in Primal Hunt. But I believe their class ones are actually slightly different. But yeah, you know, so you can have human on human, you know, in that. And you can set the ratio even 1-to-1. And at that point, it's been a while since I played it, but I figure it's just that the two players, you know, switch places rather than, yeah. I found one match in the 2 weeks I was playing, and to be fair, I wasn't like playing multiplayer all throughout the day, because again, the multiplayer in this, yeah. I did, however, check every few hours, so yeah, there's, yeah, and I did not find any. Then we have the mode called Infestation, where one player, again selected at random, is an alien, and if a Marine dies, even if it's not at the hands of the alien, he becomes an alien. And yeah, that means you have to stick together, really cover each other, a lot of fun. It plays somewhat like Left 4 Dead 2 or, you know, versus mode, or more, you know, more to the point, Contagion, because you're not just losing an ally, you're gaining an enemy. So it gets proportional, you know, exponentially. Well, I guess proportional. Exponentially more difficult. I know, technically not, whatever. You know what I'm saying, for every Marine that dies. And yeah. And the, yeah, that mode is also in the first game. And in the second game, it's again, you can pick any of the, you know, both sides can have any of the four, you know, both sides can have the same side, the same of the four, but other than that, it's completely free. And the second one also has one where there's a time limit that, you know, in this case, the Marines have to survive for, which, you know, really gives them a goal, which again, I'm sorry, but Left 4 Dead 2, there is a goal for both sides. The special infected try to kill the other side, while the human, you know, the survivor side try to get from point A to point B in the level. So yeah, it's good to have a goal. You know, there's probably like a time limit also, but yeah, it's just, okay, fair enough. There's probably a time limit. Well, yeah, that's again where in the first and the second, you can also have it limited by lives, so that The alien players can only die so and so many times before they're just out of that match. So yeah. And the second one also has one where it's getting from point A to point B, like Left 4 Dead. At three different times I found matches, and I found at least five matches and played several. I didn't play it every single time, but yeah. And that does bring up something again, really bad rules for Survivor. Yeah. If a Marine player dies, he is just dead. He has to wait until the match. I'm not sure you can join that one in progress. I think it's only the rest of it. I'm not entirely sure. Or maybe it's just when that player dies, that's it. And so if there's just one player left, you just the other three are just waiting for him to die so that they can be in the match again. And that just, yeah, not a good way to do it. And then there's, of course, deathmatch, team deathmatch, which is, species team deathmatch, which, it's in all three games. And yeah, you're attacking with the other, group of, yeah. And it's a lot of fun to attack as a pack of aliens. It's also a lot of fun to run around, a hunting party as predators and, a unit as marines. And there is mixed species deathmatch, which is not in the first or second games, where, yeah, there are two or three teams. And anyone can play as any of the three species on any of the three teams. There's no limit in that. That's where you get some really cool, like, which again is just not played as often. It's not as, the most common I found was just straight up species deathmatch. And yeah, it's. I did get to play mixed, but yeah, and it's a lot of fun going toe to toe as predators or as aliens, two marines shooting each other. To be fair, that is also true of regular deathmatch, but again, the one I found, actually, there might be around the same amount. It might be that I chose species deathmatch rather than, yeah, there's a pretty decent amount of both deathmatch and species deathmatch. And then there is domination, where you're fighting over control points. It's fairly typical as far as those go. I found one match in the 2 weeks that, yeah. The multiplayer maps, they have invisible walls. They do. I described the Survivor maps before. The regular multiplayer maps are much like that, although, in addition, they also might have, those are more varied. They might have really narrow corridors, and be inside, be very tight for the aliens, a lot of darkness, vertical and horizontal surfaces. Or they might be very open, maybe well lit, there may be tall pillars or trees that, predators can focus jump to, and where aliens can, follow them or sneak up on them. They're not safe up there necessarily. And the pyramid level deserves description. It's much like the first Alien vs. Predator film. Every so often, walls and such will move, and blocks will move in place. So yeah, walls, rising and falling, stairs are made and or unmade, and yeah, it totally changes the direction, how you move from one place to another. And the narrow you know, there are a lot of narrow corridors, and you may be forced to go through them as marine predator, and the alien is just, you know, in like a kid in a candy store in those. It's just, it's the best place to be an alien, is one of those narrow corridors where you can very easily, yeah, because it's insanely fast. And yeah, and there's nowhere to go in corridors and such, you know, you just have to. And at the same time, a corridor may be blocked by this, so yeah. And, you know, it was a decent enough concept in the film. I mean, Paul W. Anderson, he does come up with some fine ideas every so often. It's just his execution botches it, but it's perfect for a video game. And, yeah, it's just, it's a lot of fun, but it also serves to point out that it's the only level that has a truly compelling and, you know, memorable element like that. There are only 6 multiplayer maps. The first one has 13. The second one has 12, and if you have Primal Hunt also, that adds 4. You know, the second one has, like, you know, a colony, there's a bunker, there's an outpost, there are various ships of different sizes and types. You know, there's a warship similar to the Sulaco, you know, where they're being briefed in Aliens the movie, you know, before they go into the dropship and down onto the planet's surface. It even has, you know, dropships in dock, at least one, it's been a while. You know, the first game, you know, you've got the Nostromo from the first movie, you've got Hadley's Hope, the colony from the second movie, you've got the Space Jockey. Again, not going to give away exactly what movie that is. You know, you have the main setting of Alien 3. You know, Carly Fiorina, this machine run by the ugliest, figuratively speaking, of humanity. You know, did I mention that it's, you know, it's made of steel? Unfeeling, unthinking steel. You know, there's, and by contrast, in this game, most of the maps are set on this one planet. It's just the utter lack of imagination and creativity to this game is astonishing. Now, the as others have pointed out, the servers often let on, you know, too many players. It, you know, and that's again where the, you know, where the unequalness of the players, you know, if you're an alien, even one predator can be too much. And if there are several, yeah. And yeah, you know, ideally, you know, two on each of the three teams, all three teams, three on all three teams, something like that. You know, instead, it's kind of just a rush, you know, just kind of just a mess with them, the teams just rushing at each other, and you don't get to see their unique, you know, traits and abilities really come into play. And yeah, if the, you can buy additional maps, of course, and I will briefly get into those, but if you, even if you do, even if you're like, I'm okay with paying extra money for something that should have come with six maps if you don't buy. Even if you don't mind it personally, it requires the other players to have those maps and to be playing them at the time you want to be playing them. Yeah. And if you can't particularly find maps, again, I'll get to that in a second. If you don't find matches with the multiplayer maps that you get in the DLC, I have both DLC, then the only thing you can play are the co-op maps, which you can play in single player, of which there are two in both of the, you know, yeah, both DLC, and again, they don't open up. Yeah, I'll get into details on them. The bug hunt map pack is, you know, yeah, the levels in it are fine. You know, the survivor map called Tempest is, it has some good, you know, it uses weather effects. It's like this, you know, this really bad storm, and it's, yeah. And yeah, that's about it. I did not find a single, yeah, I think this was the one where I didn't find a single match. Yeah, just, you know, I don't recommend getting it. Actually, the map Furious in the Bug Hunt map pack, I did find a single match of. It's nothing special. I read that it's like, it has like a furnace in the middle. I saw no one, and I myself did never get like harmed at all by the heat down there. I don't know. And again, one match. So yeah, still not worth getting the DLC. And I may not have mentioned the survivor mode. I never found anyone playing. The swarm map pack, you know, again, I didn't find anyone playing the two non-survivor maps, regardless of mode, you know, and they're for every mode except survivor. So it's not like it's so limited by mode. No. The shawarma pack has the shawarma has the hive survivor map, which is fairly decent. That's where you get like, you know, eggs, you know, a hive in a lower human installation, which, you know, that makes sense. That's where the queen, you know, makes its hives. And yeah, the eggs do open and there are face huggers. So, you know, and that is the only place that is not purely single player where there are eggs and face huggers and a hive. So yeah. And yeah, again, I don't recommend it, and that includes on sale. I got it on sale, and if it wasn't for this review, I would regret buying them. Now, the graphics are fine. They're not that visually memorable or impressive. It's just, yeah, they're fine. This is where I get into the controversial. I try to do that at the end of my videos now. The alien has always been rapey, right from the first film, and that was very intentional. The I believe it's Dan O'Bannon, the script writer, or maybe it was the other one, specifically said, you know, rape is how I'll attack the audience, how I'll assault them. And when it was just a monster we feared, that was perfectly okay. The first two games decidedly shy away from anything other than, except for the fact that in the second one and in Private Hunt, you get to play as a face hugger. Again, everyone you attack is just really awful people. And again, you know, in this, most of the people you attack are still awful people, but this really accentuates the rapey nature of the alien itself and the facehuggers. I understand that some people were really offended by the utterly, just immensely gory, you know, yeah, the grab kills, maybe especially the predator ones. And I understand, they are really gory. I agree with one of the people behind it said that it fits, you know, this what you see him do in the movies. Now the player gets to do it. You know, it's an adult game, and I completely agree with him on that. I don't think we should. I am pro ratings and against censorship. We should get to do and see and listen to what we want. You know, as far as do, obviously not, you know, what is it? My freedom of expression. Yeah, my freedom ends, you know, where your face begins, something like that. You know, I can't punch you in the face. I don't have the freedom to do that. That is not allowed. But other than that, if you're not harming anyone else, we should get to do it. And it's just that, yeah, trigger warnings, you know, I'm not saying that everyone, obviously you should not be, you know, you shouldn't have to, you shouldn't be surprised by something like that. You should be warned of it. But I do think that once we have proper ratings, once, for example, yeah, and I, you know, rape is something that is warned about in like MPAA ratings, you know, they will say including rape. Although I'm not entirely sure they, you know, use the metaphor of the rape of the alien, but it's, yeah, obviously someone who is very upset by that should be warned of it. And then, I'm sorry, then it is the responsibility of either that person themselves, or if they are like a minor or something, the person who is in charge of them, that make sure that they don't see something or hear something or whatever. The rest of us shouldn't have to walk on eggshells all the time just because, I mean, if you never explore rape, then it never gets... There are a lot of people who think that rape is a guy who jumps out from the shadows and who violently assaults. Rape is sex without consent, or rather, sex without consent is not sex, it is rape. Sexual assault at the very least. Well, actually, yeah, if it's sex, it's rape. But, and that's not just, it's not necessarily an assault. Husbands can rape wives. We know now, because there have been studies, the most likely rapist is someone you already know. So you have to, anyone who might rape has to understand what consent is. And anyone, everyone should understand what consent is. And those who are maybe too young to fully understand or the like, they should just, yeah, understand that if someone in their family, one of their friends, does something that they find very uncomfortable, they are allowed to, you know, yeah. Again, you know, I don't know, that's almost getting into censorship, but at that point it becomes the adult in the situation. You know, if a child experiences something that they are uncomfortable with, yeah, to an extent they get to go to the parent, guardian, whatever, and say, this just happened and it really upset me. And then, you know, then the adult deals with, is this actually, yeah. However, in this game, the rape is made very, the rape is put in the hands of the player with the ability to, the first I'll take the one that is maybe less. When you grab kill as an alien, the animation may be very rapey. And usually how it'll be is that the tail will sort of caress like the cheek or the like, will run up the, you know, up the chest of, you know, before it then kills them. And, you know, and there's obviously also the head biting, which, yeah, actually, that's probably why they did it different in case you didn't see that part of the review here or you forgot or anything. In the first two games, you know, it might take the head off or, you know, knock the head off, it might eat the whole head. That doesn't seem that rapey overall because it bit the head off. That's not something we necessarily think of as, you know, genital mutilation maybe, but not rape. And yeah, in this, you see it go like through the eye socket, and yeah, that makes it more rapey, and that's again part of the rapey, yeah. And it's, yeah, that's one part of it. And another is that in single player, if someone, especially if someone's like unarmed, you can harvest them, which means, you know, the basic, a short description of it would be that you make it be impregnated by a facehugger. You might already feel like we're getting into iffy territory. The actual animation has the alien grabbing the human, holding him down. Then the facehugger comes up and attaches itself to the face. It doesn't get much rapier than that, outside of just straight up rape, which I don't personally know of a game that lets the player rape. But yeah, that's, I haven't heard of like controversy regarding that. That to me is the thing that's just extremely, that's uncomfortable, and that's, it's not something you can do in the game, it's something that's encouraged to do in the game. I mean, again, I don't know about like the points and the rating, but I imagine it's something the game rewards. It's, you know, it's not something you can do to every, you know, enemy, it's only specific ones, and it means that you didn't kill the unarmed one. So yeah, it's you know, if you find someone unarmed where the predator might say, you know, I'm not going to kill that one, the alien says, I'm going to orally rape that person. And yeah, I mean, for all the times that we've seen the quote-unquote birth, the chest burster coming out of the chest of, you know, someone who's been cocooned, for all we see of that in these, yeah, it wasn't, the games weren't this rapey in the player's hands before this one. And yeah, I think it really crosses a line, and because it's not really exploring the rape, it's the the victim is not a character. The victim doesn't, we don't get follow-up. We don't see what it does to someone. Yeah, he's not going to live for that long. Waking up after that is still, and he's still, he isn't dead when it attaches itself to his face. He might not be conscious, but he can still feel things. And yeah, that's just, if it could be done, if it followed up on the character, then if it was done right, it could be acceptable. And it's only acceptable, rape is only acceptable if you follow up on it, if you explore what it does. That's another problem with Requiem, because ooh, they're so edgy. And yeah, this is how you could do it. The player character, a human player character in one of these games, is face hugged, and the rest of the game, actually, yeah, maybe don't even have it, maybe at most have like, maybe he gets to then kill the queen or something before it ends to you know, get some revenge for to keep it from happening again, you know, but maybe not like a huge shooter, but have it actually, have the character actually reflect on how it happened, what it did to him emotionally. And yeah, have it actually be, yeah, take it seriously. Take it seriously. That's really all we feminists ask for. And yeah, rad fems might ask more. I'm not making apologies for rad fems. They don't represent me. Or making excuses, rather. They don't represent me any more than the most vile MRAs represent, you know, any man who isn't a big fan of feminism. So, yeah. And yeah, they didn't have to put it in the game. They it's very clear that at least on some subconscious level, they knew what they were doing, because it is, like I said, as rapey as it gets without being rape. And yeah, like the directors of Requiem, they probably thought they were being edgy. There is no excuse. It's unacceptable. And yeah, I mean, from that alone, from that decision alone, I would say that, you know, it's, I would understand if someone didn't play this from that decision alone. If I had known that it would be in this, yeah, I wouldn't have bought it. I wouldn't have given it any attention other than to spread the awareness that, and this is how I end a review about, you know, monsters tearing each other apart and it being cool and scary in the good way. The game brought this on itself. And again, I did choose to cover this as the very last thing. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.